Hello and welcome along to the third episode of the Treasure Rats. Last session, we finished up a dungeon and ran away from the final enemy. And today we will pick up as we arrive outside the dungeon. Today I have playing with me, Miago.
Hey, my name is Prime. I am playing Arkorivos. He is a mind flare wizard artificer. And just here to have some fun.
I have Josh.
Hi, I'm Josh. I will be playing Felix Nuri, who is a dragon bloodline sorcerer, patron of the Tarot Master Warlock, who's a reborn tiefling who can see the future.
Mind blown. I have Rico, whose character intro is almost as long, to be fair.
Yeah, I'll try to keep it brief. I'm Rico. I'm playing Elmore, the skeleton bard rogue.
Outlaw rogue. The awakened undead skeleton outlaw rogue bard complicated thing.
Let's condense that.
Yeah, that's me. I'm Joe. I play Bellows, who is essentially a steam genasi barbarian, sort of a reflavored elemental totem path.
Cool. So, as I said, we fled from our dungeon in fear and worry, and we found ourselves coming out towards the airship, where camp had been made local to the airship. And as you come out, you would, of course, be greeted by Cleo. Sort of looks at you and, oh, you're out already. Were you successful?
We located both the, it holds up the crystal.
Oh, marvellous.
And, the lava caves that, lie underneath as well.
Oh, the lava caves? Oh, that is very exciting. And, immediately, Naxillian comes running over. Can we go immediately? And so Cleo looks at you all and perhaps you might grant them a rest beforehand?
We will be much more comfortable going tomorrow than trying to push on today.
Oh, well, of course. Besides, I have spells prepare and such, you know, as it is. Well, that being said, I have to say, Brandy here makes some wonderful food. There is an excellent pheasant stew on, if you wish to join us for a meal.
I believe a celebration is in order.
Cleo is giving him the cider, as in, like, how are you inviting my crewmates to dinner on my ship when you don't belong here? Immediately, S3 Fixit, or Sethi as we know, comes down and starts sort of offering to help you with carrying stuff and... Oh, come on, let's take you up the stairs and can I take your bags and would you like this and would you like that and can I get you a drink and, you know, all sorts of annoyance. But the essence of it is you can have a nice meal and get some sleep. So if you want to go ahead and take a long rest, you may do so.
All right, I would.
And, I think it'd be a nice early morning for everyone. And I am going to fast forward through time and let you skip to the level of the dungeon in which the lava lair was. Though I think when we arrive, your characters are all going to be where we ran away from. So we will need to vaguely reset towards the beginning of the dungeon. But the following morning, you set on in. I'll just move you all back over to here, I think is a good idea. Brankus and Naxillian will join you. Do we have a token for them? I don't think I have a token for them. Oh, I do have a token for them. Look at me, so prepared. That is Naxillian and Brankus. And if you remember, this was a veritable gauntlet of things to dodge. I think you identified most of them. Oh, turns out you identified, as far as you know, all of them. So you should be able to navigate in and around them, and as you do so, you can make your way through, see what you find.
Alrighty.
Somewhere.
Is someone moving Nexilian and...
Yeah, I'll bring them in a second. I'm just struggling to find what I'm looking for. U2 style. bear with me a second. Just there. Because there is a new group of enemies around the corner that I think our Corvos will have just about been able to see.
Maybe change the screen for the stream.
Thank you. Too many things. Too many screens. Ah, Discord's posted. Excellent. That's what we like to see. And yes, you may keep going until you can see the enemies.
All right.
But there are some enemies just around the corner.
Oh, see the corner, some stuff over here.
Yes, and I believe... Why has this not worked?
Huh. Do like tactical hand signal for stop.
Yep, and at that point you will, I'm afraid, just have to wait for me for a second. Ah, there we go. Yes, fantastic. As you recall, you have fought some of these before. These strange-looking fire-newty creatures, although this time a couple of them wield weapons that you're... or one of them wields a weapon that you haven't seen before. You will remember that they were immune to fire damage. And they tried to hit you with weapons and fiery cantrip-y stuff. One of them, I believe, had... Ah, no. So they had these sort of fire rays, these pew-pew-pew fire attacks. At this moment, as you see them, Brancus will start charging towards them. Say, don't worry, I will protect us all! That's very nice, isn't it? I didn't mean to roll your initiatives. Wow, you guys might want to take my rolls. I have rolled initiative for you, apparently, and our Corvos, I don't think you've ever been so fast in your life. To roll initiative, please. I don't even know how I've done that.
Lower, probably.
Yes, that is a whole... Oh, I don't quite even do maths anymore. Oh, my brain's gone 15 points lower. Cool. So, charging on into the fight, Bellows stands there, shield up at the ready. You see him focus as some sort of magic surrounds him, an aura of some sort. After that,
or whatever that guy's name is, I don't do.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah. I was like, oh. What?
Bellows does none of those things.
Brancus. Sorry.
Brancus.
Yes, I also skipped your turn because of it. I said Bellows, then immediately took Bellows' turn for him. Bellows, yeah, you're up.
Okay.
You know there to only be two fights in this cave. I'll tell you that for
free. Right. Yeah. I know. It's his flaw is wastes resources for fun anyway. So.
Yeah.
Clanks around on the boots and begins his version of rage, at which point he will then... Yeah, he could get over here anyway, I believe, so I'm not going to worry about it. Well, let's see. It's how far it would be. 5, 10, 20, 25, 30, 40, 35, yeah. That would be my... That.
With a lovely ruler tool, every single person just counts the squares. Me included.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's like, I don't know if... I couldn't remember if these holes counted as something.
Mm-hmm.
Difficult or anything like that. But I can just hop over stuff at my speed and strength anyway. Well, if that guy's rushing up here, I don't know if I know if he knows what he's... Does he look like he knows what he's doing?
Oh, yeah. He's a preservation cleric that works for the Enclave. He's got a shield that's like 6 foot tall and 2 foot wide, okay. And he sort of sturdied it down and stood with himself behind it.
All right, well, I don't have to move over there, but I'm going to hit the guy on the right.
Yeah.
Recklessly, why not?
Yep. Desperately looking for something.
So that is a 17 to hit.
The guy on the right, that will hit.
Okay.
Goodness me, is that really his armor class? Okay, cool.
And that is, ooh, big damage. 16 crushing, bludgeoning damage.
Oh, okay. That is where the magical aura around Brancus seems to be hitting. 16, did you say 16 bludgeoning damage?
Yeah. I think that's what I said.
Jesus. Alright, he didn't like that.
Well, because I can, I'm gonna use my dash and go back over here.
Okay. Nice.
So that they can't all fire me at once. they can fire this idiot.
Yep. The next up is the warlock. In the front, that is this enemy A, as we might call him. Sorry, no, enemy B, the one that you hit. You hit the one on the right, correct?
Yes, correct.
Okay, and he will fire three flame darts, and immediately Brancus uses his reaction to put his shield in front of them, blocking them from hitting anybody else. Lucky him, look at those rolls. That is 22 fire damage. Oh, never mind, the 6 will miss him. That's 15 fire damage. And that brings us to Felix Nuri, who I believe now has his cantrip, feat that allows him to actually do something to these, correct?
It sure does, thank God. Felix is, cards will start, set ablaze. Raise his hand and fire out a fiery eldritch blast.
A fiery eldritch blast, indeed.
Is there a 21 to hit?
A 21 will hit. I'm really sorry, Josh. Who are you shooting?
I am shooting this guy.
Okay, cool.
And that is 9.
Yes, that will hit.
Cool. And that's 9 fire damage.
Okay, go ahead and make a dexterity save, please.
Oh man, are you sure?
Yeah, as you see, he raises his hand in anger as you fire at him.
It's a 6.
Okay, you will take 7 fire damage in return from a hellish rebuke. Very mean, isn't it?
I know what my next feat's gonna be.
What feat can you take that will stop you taking damage from hellish rebuke?
Resistance to fire.
Oh, that's a feat. Yeah.
Clever boy.
Does that conclude your turn, Felix?
It sure does.
Cool.
Can I hellish rebuke his hellish rebuke?
Yeah.
I'm not going to.
Okay, cool. I'm afraid it's not Elmore's turn quite yet. It is Naxillian's, and he will cast haste on Arcorimus.
Oh.
Alright.
He has no spells that target anyone other than allies. very useful of me that I've made this character. Elmore, you're up.
Alright, Elmore is going to... where's my fucking ruler? 30 feet. I'm going to go about there.
Yep.
And I am going to take a shot at the salamander in the front. That is,
yep.
Or the newt in front next to Brancus. With the boomcaster.
Indeed. Go ahead.
18 to hit.
An 18 will hit.
Nice.
I'll roll it here.
Ooh.
10 damage.
Oh, okay. I misread that. I was adding the 10, the 6, and the 4 together.
Yeah. I was
that
like,
would have been a lot of damage.
I was like, no.
okay. Does that conclude your turn?
Let me see here. Yeah, I think so.
Brilliant. Arcorimus, you are hasted, and it is your turn.
All right, so double my normal movement rate. So.
Apologies, this enemy is wounded.
40. So I'm going to go here, and I'm going to throw an ice knife
there.
Mm-hmm. So he's going to pull up his stein and pop open the lid, and one of his tentacles is going to dip in and just flick a little bit of moisture that's going to turn into a little icicle that's going to shoot out and hopefully stab a dude.
Yep.
Let's see how we do.
That is a
17
hit,
plus 7. Yep. AC at 24.
That'll hit, and then all three of them make a dex save, is that correct?
So the one that gets hit, by the, all kinds of stuff's popping up here.
When you click roll on that spell, everything happens.
Apparently. Look at that.
Take 5 piercing damage, is that correct?
Yep, so the one I hit takes the 5 piercing damage.
And then I didn't get over a 13 on my dex save.
And then... It's all hidden here. And then they all get to take 2d6 cold damage. 9. There we go.
That was a lot better than the 3 you rolled the first time. Yeah, I don't know if you realize it already rolled that 2d6 for you.
Oh, and it's somewhere.
Yeah, okay. It was a really shit roll. It was 3.
Oh, there it is, piercing, cold damage, cold damage.
You went for the 2d6 and rolled a 9, so we'll take it. That's great.
At this point...
Oh, hold on. What have I just done then? I've just done 19. At this point, our little friend here is now severely wounded.
Alright.
Yep.
This guy here with my bonus action... he gets to make a strength saving throw as I try to telekinetically shove him 5 feet back.
16, I'm afraid.
All right.
I've rolled off the wrong one, but I believe they have the same... Yeah, they do. Then have the same stat. 40,
45, 50, 60. Okay, and then I will conclude my movement there.
Mm-hmm.
And then with haste, I can take... What can I do with that extra action? I know there's limits.
You can cast one spell, make one attack, I believe.
There we go. I can make one attack, dash, disengage, hide, or use object. I knew I couldn't cast another spell. So, dash, disengage, hide. I don't really need to do
you can't cast
any
spell?
Of those thing. Nah, I can't. You can make a single weapon attack, dash... Yeah, disengage, hide, or
haste,
use object.
Haste generally favors like the melee builds more than casters, unfortunately.
Okay,
I'm gonna dash.
I've always
so
let
I can
people
move
use spells in a second. 15, yeah, don't do that. That's great, marvelous.
So, okay. There we go. I'll dash with the haste. Get up in the face.
Cool. You're not within the bright blue light of Brancus's aura. Do you
correct.
Want to be?
Why not?
Brilliant. Okay. That leads us to our little friend, who has been severely, has been untouched at the back, actually, almost untouched. He will fire 3 fire rays, one at Arcodivos for a 10.
Nope.
A second at Arcodivos for an 11.
Nope.
And a third one for a 10. Look at those for some rolls.
Nice.
The next enemy, however, will ask you and Brancus to make a dexterity saving throw, please, as he will cast Burning Hands. Which I believe is a 3d6.
Yep.
Okay, so you will take a quarter of the damage as you are within the aura of fire resistance your lovely friend is giving you. Look at that. Which means you will only take 2 fire damage, although ironically, if you had have stayed where you went, the Burning Hands wouldn't have been able to hit you. but I thought it might you might get hit by more than just the Burning Hands. Cool, and that will conclude their turns. This battle music is sounding very,
like tavern-y.
Like not a battle music, yes.
Yeah.
Let's do the skip button. Okay, cool. Bellows! No, Brancus. Brancus is up. Brancus will look at you all and decide that none of you need healing. And therefore he will cast Blade Ward upon himself. Actually, he can bonus action. I'm not going to use the spell slot. Cool. Bellows, you're up.
All right, she'll rush back into the fray. Bash that guy who's the most hurt.
Mm-hmm.
Love you to join us.
Once again, recklessly. Or 16.
That'll hit.
Yeah, it's gonna do. Oh, I'm really, really well. 10 plus 3 is 13, plus 2 more is 15. Bludgeoning damage.
When does Hellish Rebuke happen? When you take damage, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm assuming if the hit is going to kill me, I cannot cast it.
I'm not sure.
I think you would take the damage first.
Yeah, I think so too. Cool, he's down.
To satisfy the requirements of the reaction.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, sure. Otherwise he wouldn't have taken any damage, yes. Great, so he's down, Bellows.
And I will... move the rest of the way up in here just to get their faces, and I will use my new fancy thing to use the help action. I will sort of poke at this guy on the right. I'm not able to actually hit him, but I'll keep him busy and tell him to
bury him.
Pay attention to me. Yes.
What's the mechanics of that?
That gives the next person attacking him advantage, basically.
Okay, brilliant. Well, before that, he will attack you. And I'm afraid that's you fine. Are close enough. Oh, hold on, that's a ranged spell attack. Let's not do that.
Probably gets disadvantage.
No, no, he's
close enough
you.
Isn't good.
He's going to hit you with a Morning Star. so that's a 19 to hit.
Yeah, it's.
So that is 6 bludgeoning damage. Piercing damage, cool. It says, actually. I don't know why it says piercing damage. It's a Morning Star.
Either
of
those
I suppose
are good.
It's got spikes, yeah, that's fine. 12 to hit you.
12 does not hit.
And a 23 to hit you, which is a natural 20, does. I'm afraid.
Okay.
And you are, I'm afraid, not in range of our other friend. So you'll take 5 on a crit.
And that's still...
Yeah, all 3 of those are piercing damage, so you can half them all. So it's 2 on that one. 2 damage crit, there you go. Isn't that nice?
Wonderful.
Felix Nori, I believe it's you.
Yeah, I'm going to move up here, and then I am going to fire out another Eldritch Blast at this guy.
Yep.
And I roll with advantage, right? Because of bows?
Yes, I believe so. Yep. Does it count towards ranged hits as well, Joe?
Yeah, it should be fine. Yeah. Great.
Thank God, because that's a nat 1. That's not much better. That's a 13.
13 will hit.
Oh, nice. That's 1 fire damage. The nat 1s are loving me today.
Congratulations. That is excellent. Okay, brilliant. Does that conclude your turn? I've lost my encounter.
Sure does.
Okay, our friend Naxilian will cast... Oh, that's a weird one. Sanctuary on Bellows? No, I think he'll cast Sanctuary on Arcorivos. Makes more sense. Also, he seems to like Arcorivos for some reason. Something to do with smelly music. Elmore, you're up!
Okay, so Elmore is going to swing the old boomcaster behind his back and pull out his fancy new sword.
Oh, right.
And as he is running towards this spot here, he is going to use a bonus action to chant the command word or phrase, which is goodness gracious, short sword of fire.
Yeah.
And he'll take a stab at this guy that's basically adjacent.
Lovely. Go ahead, roll to hit.
17.
Yep.
Okay. So that'll be...
Nice.
Did that come through?
That'll be 12 damage. As you will recall, at the beginning of the fight, you were informed that these are immune to fire damage.
Correct.
Well, if they're immune, then how is Felix hitting
them? He's got his elemental adept feat.
That only ignores resistance, not immunity.
I believe it turns immunity to resistance.
I don't think so. I don't care. Please empower the person who helps me kill things. But...
Yeah, I'm okay with him doing it, but rules as written normally does not.
You lied to me, Josh.
Please don't take this away.
You lied to me. You said it turns immunity to resistance, but it sure as hell doesn't. There is something that does turn immunity to resistance, but I believe it's a class feature of a specific class.
I think with his dragon stuff, when he gets really far along, if dragon sorcerer might do that.
Oh, okay. I was thinking it was a storm sorcerer or tempest.
Yeah, I'm not sure, but...
Yes, interesting. Interesting. That is a discussion we should have after this moment.
It's not. Doesn't look distracting.
Yes. Regardless, Elmore, I'm afraid they are immune to fire damage.
That's all good.
The 12 slashing damage has almost piercing damage, right? Has almost piercing killed damage. It.
Nice. Bonus action. I'll keep that in the back pocket. Oh, actually, I used it. I used it to activate the sword.
Remember. Yes, you did. Arcorivos, you're up. The enemy directly in front of you is almost dead.
Let me see.
Eat his braid.
kind of what I'm going for. I just don't know if I should try to knock him prone first and then eat his brain, as long as that damage doesn't kill him. So I'm going to the guy right in front of me, I'm going to use a telekinetic slam on him, so he gets to make a strength saving throw. DC 15. All right. Two force damage and is knocked prone. So then, when I attack him with my face tentacles, I have advantage, which will be my hasted action.
My mic is muted. You cut out on the number for me? Sorry? On the number of the damage?
Two.
Okay, fantastic.
Yep, just two.
That is not quite enough to finish the poor bastard.
Excellent.
That was the plan,
I think.
So, an
AC 26 hit. It was
yes.
The plan. Alright, so I'm going to hit him with my face tentacles for 6 psychic damage.
Nice. It is dead.
And if that kills him, I'm going to eat his brain.
Lovely. Tasty. This is a fine brain taste. Like.
These fire creatures are exceptionally spicy. It's lovely. And then bonus action, I'm just going to try to telekinetically shove that guy.
Sure. You can go on. Can
with
push?
My telekinesis feat. Again, DC 15 strength check.
I have decided to not roll it. 7, there you go.
Yeah. Actually, you know what? I'm going to pull him toward me. Just to be more intimidating.
Cool, love that.
And just be in a really place because he's just surrounded by people.
Mm-hmm.
You will not get away to...
Does that conclude your turn?
Leap.
Oh, you have lagged out.
Yeah, that's my turn.
Okay,
yep.
There we go. As the creature swings at you, you will feel a sort of mental intrusion from Brancus. Are you willing to swap places with him? That is at...
Sure.
Arcoribos. Okay, so he shall use his reaction to turn you round on the spot, apparently. to swap places with you, taking the hits for you, and the mace hits will go into him. Morningstar. Well, two of them will miss, and one of them will not.
Oh.
Dealing... Oh, that's a nat 20 again, isn't it? So that is 5 uh-huh. damage. Cool. He's liking that. He used his blade ward. He's pretty chill. That's actually his turn. Does anybody have a kinship? Nope. Cool, he'll do the same thing again. Felix, you are up. Bellows, you're up. Sorry, I don't know why I went to skip your turn. It's because Bellows and Brancus look like the same word in my head. Apparently.
Okay. Well, you know, they've done that study. Have you ever read one of those things where, like, they mix everything in the middle, but as long as the first letter and the last letter are the same, you can read it like it's correct?
You can read it in the entire sentence, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to do what I always do. I'm going to hit this motherfucker.
Yeah.
Let's see here. Reckless.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's going to be a 23.
Uh-huh.
And, okay, good. Balances out my way high damage rolls before. That's only 7.
Okay. That is going to make him injured. But not
and,
dead.
And I will just keep yelling at him.
Cool.
As a way of distracting him and giving the help action.
Okay. Felix, you're up.
Can I even attack it?
Yeah.
With its immunity?
For now, I'm letting it go through because I said it was how it was. Like, we'll discuss it out of this moment. I get let the first thing do damage, so you might as well do the damage of the second thing. It looks to be severely injured. Or injured, sorry.
Okay. Do I have enough line of sight, or do I need to move?
Depends what you're doing.
Firing a spell.
Like Eldritch Blast?
Yeah,
sure, that's fine.
Okay.
As far as I'm concerned with Eldritch Blast, it's not like a physical projectile that you're trying to, you know, you're just aiming at him. So go ahead.
That's a 24 to hit.
Yeah.
Curving the bullet around Brancus, man.
Yeah, it's a difference between firing a bullet and throwing an axe for me.
Yeah, that's how I...
Or a total of 2 fired.
Okay, funnily enough, he's still wounded. not much has changed there. Naxilian will look to Elmore and say, strike hard. And he will give you advantage on your next attack using True Strike. Which technically only should be usable for him, but he has the other version. the slightly more useful True Strike. I'd completely forgotten, in all honesty, that there was a True Strike that wasn't the version that I've homebrewed, which just says give a target advantage on its next attack. Still not the best cantrip in the world, but go on.
Well, I guess with that encouragement, I'll turn my head back towards him. I'll sort of like, because my head will sort of shift back towards him while my body's still facing forward, and say, "Oh, I'm always hard, baby." And then I'll take another stab at our friend.
That's interesting facts about Elmo learned today.
Because he's a skeleton.
Yes, I know he's always made of bone.
He has no soft tissue.
But let's be frank, that's not how that sounded to anyone.
21 to hit.
Yep, a 21 will hit. This is me realizing I haven't got my notebook. Ouch.
And so that'll be 13.
13? Holy shoot. Okay, he is on the brink of death.
Oof, if only that fire did anything. And I'll end my turn.
Cool. Arcorivos. The enemy is almost dead. You're going to eat two in one turn. Two in one fight. How fast does he eat?
I will do my best. So I'm going to circle around him with this haste, just moving all blurry fast. And I'm just going to try to eat his brain. Because why not?
Lovely. Go ahead, roll for it. You'll be flanking. More advantage.
All right. Boom. Oh, 14.
14 will hit.
Excellent.
I'm sure the last time we fought these guys, they didn't have 10 armor class.
Lap him for 6 psychic damage.
You may eat.
Excellent. Again, wraps his tentacles around, kind of squeezes in as the tentacles burrow through his soft tissue and pull out his brain real quick. And a double. This is Brandy is an excellent cook, but she will never compare to this. And bonus action, psycho metabolic surge. Mm-hmm. And that should be it.
That is it. You may each take 100 XP.
100.
Excellent.
Obviously, it's being divided by 6 right now.
Mm-hmm.
As they like to think that they're contributing. I'm not sure if they are contributing or not, but.
I'd say so.
One of them is taking every single hit. Yes, I'm sure the haste could be better aimed and will be in future. I really thought you could cast a second spell with that. This effect actually is going to last 10 minutes, so I suppose you'll keep concentrating on it. Can I not target two things at once in this? Oh, I can, but it's going to... Yeah, there we go. Okay, and he'll race over here because he's cool like that. You guys.
This is almost too easy to be fun with that guy along.
An accident tells you, yes, he is quite effective in combat, although he doesn't do anything to hurt anybody else. Something about, I don't know, cleric vows or such.
The religious type.
He made it much easier for me to consume those newt's brains, and so I am very appreciative.
Brancus turns to you, and this aura around me will enable us to resist the flames slightly. Must we walk across here? And Naxilian at this moment is like down his knees with like 3 different magnifying glasses over one eye, like staring at a rock, like an absolute fascination. And he's like, these are the lava chutes I was talking about. They heat the lake up the top and they keep things clear, and the smoke and the steam and the... This is most fascinating. My geological partners will be absolutely amazed to hear the things that I've done, and I must take some images. And he gets out a sketchbook and starts drawing, and that's the end of Naxilian. We won't see him again. Ever. But the rest of you, knowing that there is... I mean, you can see it, I think.
Yep.
The dancing fire beast over there, and Brancus says, perhaps we should charge across. Sounding more like Bellows than Brancus, but that's fine.
after you, big boy.
If you stay within my aura, not only can I give you fire resistance, but perhaps may also be able to lend you some healing on the way. He can channel his
divinity. We could also bait it to come to us if we feel more comfortable fighting from here.
if you don't mind, I'd like to make sure there's nothing over the other side so that my friend here is safe. It looks like that make over in the corner there.
Correct.
Okay, I'm really sorry, guys. This is going to be a one-step-at-a-time process. Okay. I'm going to say this aura covers you all, because I really can't be asked to move it, to be honest. So as you make your first step onto the lava, Felix, you're coming. Don't try and
close
the
outro. No, I'm not.
You can also double-click on his token and Felix give the token an aura.
Oh, okay.
What color?
Felix, wand cross.
I don't need to.
Oh, okay. I can give the token an aura.
Oh, yeah, double click and then,
Gideon!
Yeah.
How exciting.
Wow.
That is something like that. Beautiful. Holy shit, that's a lot bigger than the circle I made, isn't it? 30 feet aura is a lot bigger than I thought it was. that is huge!
Oh, yeah, yeah. You didn't make anything near a 30-foot aura.
Yeah, no, I didn't. Oh, yeah. I thought the spell I picked was a 30-foot aura, but apparently Calm Emotions is a 15-foot radius. Which, whilst 35 in diameter, is not a 30-feet aura. So, with that, he will also channel his divinity on each of your checks. You will gain 2 HP. So, instead of doing that, let's just go 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, 55. You will gain 22 HP at the end, okay? Let's not do it 2 HP at a time. But I will need checks from everybody other than Felix. One at a time. Elmore, please. If you want to just roll me 11 d20s and see how many of them are over 14,
that
works for me.
And these are con, right?
They are all con, yes.
Okie dokie.
Oh, I didn't want to roll one of them.
Let's see here. I should be able to...
You highlight it. You got a 12, 8, 10, 18, 4, 19, 18, 11, 7, 11, 1.
So you needed to get above 14. You got 3 above 14. So you will take...
I have a plus 3 to con saves.
Yes, yes. Sorry, let's do that bit first.
So then
you need to roll
one
11
fail.
Or above. So 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 failures. That's it.
4 failures. Okay, cool.
Look at you go. Oh, sorry, plus 3.
Yay.
1, 2, 4 failures.
Okay.
Okay, so you will take an 8d4 of fire damage.
Give it to me.
Which is 19 halved to 10. Half to 9. Don't even bother applying it. Just heal yourself to full health. Okay. Bellows, how many under 14s?
It's 14 with a plus 3, right?
You have a plus 3, so you just need anything below 11 is a fail. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
7 of them. 8.
Okay, 8. So you will take 16d4 fire damage, which is 39 halved to 19.
Oof.
So again, just gain 3 HP.
8.
Life is great. Yes, this guy's literally designed to get you through. Arcoribos.
It was his only job.
All right. Boom.
Oh, that
go.
Looks...
Right.
That is so... How did you make it look like that?
Yeah.
I went to the advanced dice roller and
rolled
20.
Oh, you used 20. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, because then it'll splay it out like this.
Oh, okay.
What's your modifier?
0.
0. That makes life easier.
Yeah, so I actually have to roll a 14 or higher. So,
1, 2, 8.
3. Yeah.
You will take 23 fire damage, so you will lose 1 HP.
Alright.
Fantastic. You may all move yourselves to here. And roll initiative. To over there and roll initiative. His preservation aura will, however, run out at this point. It's actually only 10 rounds, but whatever, I cheated. As well his... It's amazing that he managed to maintain concentration the whole way across, isn't it?
I know.
Cool. Yeah, I didn't think about that. Whatever. I don't care. Cool. Yeah, you may roll initiative, and I will boot that up. I don't see this being a big deal, but let's get it done anyway. Yes, encounter. Where have you gone, encounter?
Where's my buddy Felix?
He's hiding at the other side, firing 120 feet of range.
He's currently waving from a safe distance.
What a smarty pants.
Elmore, 22, correct?
Correct.
Bellows, a 13, correct?
Correct.
Felix, a 20, dirty?
Yes. Dirty, yeah.
And Okorivos, a 13, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Oh, that's probably wrong, but whatever. It's decided that Bellows goes after Okorivos. And I can change that.
Done.
Yeah, there we go. I just lower the initiatives. And I need to roll a d20.
Oh.
That is an 18. Okay. Yes, no haste. 18 for him, so he'll go after Felix. Elmore, as you approach this huge dancing flame-like creature, begins to wave its arms. And then for some reason just stands there and waits for you to hit it. Elmore, you are up.
So as Elmore approaches this huge flame creature waving his arms, he's going to run the other way. And I think camp out a little bit in this corner here by this conveniently placed treasure chest.
Mm-hmm.
And fire at him with the old Booncaster.
Yep. Assuming you reloaded that before you crossed the flames.
I did certainly reload that, and that should hit for a natural 20.
Yes, that will always hit. Do the hitting.
Here it comes. Oh, awful. Wait a minute. Why did it only roll one set?
Attack critical.
Oh, it did. Sorry. So it'll be 17 damage. Wait, no. 12 damage.
Nice.
It's 17.
Yeah,
it's 17.
Yeah.
Sorry. I was reading that wrong.
Fantastic.
That was written weird.
It was written weirdly.
And with a bonus action, I think that I'm going to look out to my party, and I'll give some bardic inspiration to Bellows in the form of some battle music, which will hopefully come next week.
Oh, good. We look forward to it. Okay. Felix Nori. You are up.
Please tell me this guy's not immune.
As I said, I'm not doing that until after...
Oh, I thought you just meant that low.
No, I'm not dealing with it until I'm not in session.
Honestly, as the person who brought it up, I just want to say it would also be fair with the Eldritch Blast, because you're already nerfing yourself by making it fire instead of force.
It makes sense with the Eldritch Blast. I'm fine with that and with the Hex. It's about, like, he's changed everything to fire damage. I think I may give you a separate thing that allows creatures to take half damage when they would previously be immune. Because obviously if we now change... Because in my head, if it said immunity is resistance and you ignore resistance, then you just ignore all resistance and immunity completely.
Oh, so you want to change it to if it's resistance, it takes normal, and if it's immune, it takes half.
Yeah, I think that's probably what we're going to do. But I have to look at just how broken that is on, like, Fireball. Right? We'll see. Nevertheless, it is your turn, and you may attack with your fire spells as and how you wish.
Thank you. I will... I will bonus action Hex.
What's the range on Hex?
90 feet.
Is it? Oh, shit, yes. I thought it was 60. Okay. And in all fairness, okay. Cool.
Yeah. So you would usually see, like, a wreath of fire around it, but this thing's made out of fire, so I don't know if you necessarily notice.
Yeah, I think it's fair to say that in the instance that the creature is immune to your fire, the fire appears sort of blue in color. Just so that it's visible.
Sure. Yep. Azula up in the sky.
Very cool.
It's like you've turned on a Bunsen burner on his body.
Okay. Then I'll fire it. Oh my god, I'll fire an Eldritch Blast.
Okay.
That's a nat 20.
Nice, that'll do. You just make light work of my fight, why don't you?
Well, I rolled like nat 1 so far.
No, I mean like both of you have rolled nat 20 so far, right?
Hell yeah.
That's a 15 fire damage with the Eldritch Blast.
And the crit on the Hex damage?
Oh, I was just going to ask if I crit there.
I believe so.
And then that's an extra 9 fire damage. So that's 24 altogether.
Okay, that's not very nice.
No.
Brancus will
I don't have two of those. I can't do fire resistance. Sorry, guys. He will cast Beacon of Hope, which may or may not be useful. We'll find out if any healing is done. I believe it also gives you advantage on wisdom saves. Is that correct? Yes, I believe so. Is it dexterity or wisdom? Yeah. I don't know.
I think wisdom.
I'm pretty sure it's wisdom. I only used it every single fucking battle on my preservation cleric for like 25 fights. Wisdom fight saving throws and death saving throws, and regains the most amount of healing when healed. Bellows, you are up.
Alright.
Oh, sorry, he's also going to take a step here.
Okay. Ooh. Well, I'm just going to step up in between people here.
Mm-hmm. Do it.
Firing up the boots as I go. Take a swing. Mm-hmm. Not recklessly under the circumstances. Oh!
No way.
A nat 1.
That's not a nat 20. That is for sure.
No. No, and it's also no point in even adding the Bardic Inspiration, which is part of why I didn't bother with Reckless on this occasion. I can back up. I'm looking to go. All right, so that was... I keep forgetting, and I think I did it wrong in the last battle. I can't activate the Rage and do the dash on the same turn,
no.
But I can keep using my regular movement for now, which is another...
And you are still... Are you still disadvantaged for opportunity attacks, even though you're not dashing?
Yes, I'm still disadvantaged. Yep. Right.
Okay.
Right. Again, other reason why I didn't reckless, because then it would be an even, so you can.
So it will go ahead and forge you with disadvantage. That's a nat one. Does that conclude your turn?
We are two incompetent things swinging at each other, and that does it for me.
Akonivos, you are up.
All right.
Ah, shit. Elmore, there is no fucking way in hell your weapon's magical, is it?
Oh, no.
My bad. Mm. Let me just go half that. I thought he was taking a bit more damage than I thought. cool. I've got a boss, you're up. He seems to be resistant to non-magical weapons.
All right. Well, there we go. All right, well, I'm gonna move over here.
Firing bullets into him. They're like, no.
He's gonna, yeah. Pop open his stein, and one of his face tentacles is gonna pull out just this 4-inch diameter blue orb, and I'm going to use a second level spell slot, cast chromatic orb, and I'm going to do cold damage. Yeah, alright. There we go.
That's bad.
And, yeah, no, just regular. There we go.
Okay.
Let's see, okay. Alright, AC 19.
Yep.
Alright. 12 cold damage.
As your ball of cold strikes, it seems to be less effective than you had hoped.
Alright.
Do you know, I didn't...
Lightning next time.
I made
he's so hot.
Some specific
yeah,
changes,
so hot.
But I was not expecting... Oh, are we having lag issues? No, Jamal, that's you, I'm afraid. Does that conclude your turn, Arcorivos?
No, I'm gonna... I don't really need to push or pull him anywhere, so yeah,
okay.
I'm good.
So that leads us to him. Every creature within 20 feet of range. Let's have a little look. 5, 10, 15, 20. Yes. Bellows and Arcorivos and Brancus. Please make a charisma saving throw.
Oof.
Fail.
15.
Okay. You are fascinated by the flames. Your next attack against the target will be a disadvantage, and there is another effect, but you don't know what it is yet. Cool. He shall then claw at Brancus, because Brancus is standing right next to him. A 10 will miss, and a 7 will miss. Great, that's good, isn't it? Elmore, you're up.
So would Elmore have realized that the bullets maybe aren't...
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. So in that
I mean,
case,
I think he might have even known before he shot it, you know, it's like it's incorporeal.
Yeah, just testing the waters, you know?
Yeah.
So in lieu of reloading the gun, I think that instead he'll sort of start playing a tune, and I'm going to cast Vicious Mockery on
Love that.
The Dancing Flame. Oh, sorry. I just rolled the damage PM.
It's all right, I've made an insight check. it's a 12.
Ooh, 12 is the DC.
Oh, so sorry. How are you mocking this fiery beast anyway?
Or is it just it's a mocking tune?
A mocking tune, basically. I'm like a little clan music.
It's playing in the Addams Family or a circus track, yes. Does that conclude your turn, Elmore?
Yes, I'm going to conclude that there.
Can I confirm that it is currently Bellows who is inspired?
Correct.
Brilliant. Excellent. Felix, you're up.
Okay, then I will fire out a big orb of fire damage.
Okay.
That's a 19 to hit?
That'll hit.
Cool. And that will be... 18 fire damage.
Cool.
And then the hex damage.
He appears to be slightly wounded.
Will be two.
Just wounded, two sorry. Okay. Does that conclude your turn, Felix?
It sure does.
Bellows, you're up.
Alright, I'm gonna walk up to it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it is sort of beautiful. But.
Your first
I want to hit it anyway.
Yep.
Yes, but I'll reckless it to make it even.
Okay, that makes sense to me.
It's going to be an 18.
An 18 will hit.
Okay.
Your weapon is also currently not magical, correct?
Correct. But it is... so it's 14. I presumably halved then.
Yes. Do I half the range damage?
Yeah, I think it's just it's part of the weapon damage.
It's part of the weapon damage, yeah. Okay, cool.
Yeah, I believe so. Yes. I'm allowed to leave it. I'm not fascinated where I can't walk away from it.
No, but at the end of your turn, you will need to make a charisma save to end the effect.
I see. Well, then I will sort of, I've come up and I've been fascinated, reluctantly take a swipe at it, but then sort of go, I think I should get farther away, mm-hmm. and blast back over. This way, I can go really far, so I'm just gonna go really far because it.
Yep.
And it hurt me. It made me weird. Okay. Yeah. Let's. There's nothing Bardic Inspiration can even do for me there, so okay. That's another fail on the charisma save.
Cool. Arcanibus, you are up.
All right. I'm gonna kind of put a little more distance because I don't like that weird charisma thing it's doing. And then I will just do a first level chromatic orb, and this time let's do thunder. Everyone likes thunder damage. A little orb of sonic energy for an AC of 24.
Yeah, that'll hit.
All right, 13 thunder damage.
The thunder definitely goes through. You know it doesn't like that.
Okay. Excellent.
And if that concludes your turn, a charisma save at the end of your turn, please.
All right. What have I got with my minus one? 7.
Okay, I'm afraid that is a fail. Is that that is the end of your turn. You must both use your reaction to make the dash action. Take the dash action towards him.
All right.
As he will give you a fiery embrace.
Ooh.
Did I not have to do that?
Yes, both of you.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, both of you. Dash action. To immediately move into melee range of it, and he will give you a fiery embrace.
It says that uses my reaction?
Yes. It says the target must use their reaction to make a dash action. To take the dash action.
Oh, see? He just wants a hug.
Yes, and that hug, I'm afraid, does 32 psychic damage.
All right. I'm unconscious.
So am I.
That is terrifying. Yes, Brancus is holding on by the thinnest of threads. He has 1 HP. And that will conclude his turn. He can only do that once a day, don't worry. Elmore, you're up. He appears to be severely wounded.
Okay.
Yes, ooh shit sounds about right.
Ooh shit sounds about right. I think that what I'm going to do on this turn is... All right, Healing Word. I'm going to cast Healing Word on Bellows,
mm-hmm.
Who will regain 5 HP.
Nice.
Tell him to get up! And
Get on up.
Exactly. With my action, I think I'm going to pull out my pistol.
I'm going to hold you there for a second. Bellows, I don't know.
Oh, wait. Psychic damage.
Don't do it.
It says starts this turn or enters for the first time. Would you be entering for the first time if you're standing up? No, I think that's fine. Well, it's when you start your turn. Sorry, Elmo, carry on.
Yeah, and I'll sort of.
Oh, what was the total psychic damage we took?
32.
I forgot I was resistant to psychic damage. Okay.
Oh. So it'd be 16 instead. Yeah.
Not down?
Yep. Down. But you heal Bellows, so nobody's down.
I chose the right one.
Yeah,
you did, absolutely.
And I'll take my shot in desperation with the pistol for 14.
I'm afraid that will miss.
Damn. Mm. And with that, I will end my turn.
Okay, Felix, you are up.
Okay, I'm gonna send out another chromatic orb.
Okay. Can that reach as well?
That's 90 feet, yeah.
Long-range beast over there.
Yes, honey.
Yep.
That's 24 to him.
That'll hit.
Cool. That is 4. That one is a 2, so that's 15 fire damage.
Oh, not quite.
And then the hex.
Oh!
Is 6.
Fantastic. Please go ahead and describe his grisly demise. You fire-slaying fire creature.
Well, yeah, how do I do this? Okay, so, like, the hex flame, like, wraps around his body even more before, like, raising it, his body up into the end and just completely dispersing.
Beautiful. So I reflavored this on the basis that the 32 psychic damage that it did should have reduced your maximum HP by an amount equal to the damage taken. And if that reduced you to 0, you were dead. And obviously I thought, well, shit, that's going to kill a bitch. However, it's not AoE normally. I'm glad there were only 2 of you in range for that. That could have been quite disastrous. And for that reason, the XP is pretty. So I've got to do some maths, because I've got to divide this by 5 instead of 4.
Quick maths.
No, not quick. Why?
calculator.
1375 divided by 5. 275 each. And it should be mentioned, actually, while I'm at it, you gained 150 XP for depositing Naxillion at the flaming pit of lava. So you may add an extra 150 on top of that 275. Which I believe should say hello, number 4.
Hello.
Cool. We will take a minute to do the leveling things, but Elmore, you seem to have been hiding by this chest.
I sure do.
Excellent. It doesn't appear to be locked.
It appears to be. I'll kick it open.
Yeah, fairly easy to. How do I turn this back on? There is 250 gold pieces inside. And there is a strange leather wrapping with a single sapphire in it.
A wrapping, as in like a cloak of some sort, or like
no, it looks like a sort cuff? Of like a bandage, a band. I don't know. Arcanibus, you are an artificer, correct, or at least somewhat.
I am.
Go ahead and give me an Arcana check with advantage, please.
All right, I'm gonna cast a couple cure light wounds on myself real quick, and now an Arcana with advantage gets us. Ooh, not bad. 21.
21. Yes, that will tell you that this is a weapon enhancement attachment. Sorry. Weapon enhancement attachment. And a sapphire of kinetic enhancement, which is the sapphire that is plugged into the leather wrapping. You may all look them up, but there is no way you're going to hand these to anybody other than Bellows, I don't think. So Bellows, go ahead.
I was already handing it to
him. And you will understand why I said it's sad that your dash action is only part of rage.
Well, I'll look in a moment. But for now, he's sort of wandered through where this fire creature was and over to the only other fire that's nearby, and it's just sort of continuing to sort of feel like maybe he... I don't know, I was going to figure something out here. I was understanding fire better, I don't know. But, He's a little mesmerized for a moment, but then he will obviously take this.
So just to let everybody else know, the weapon enhancement attachment is a simple-looking leather wrapping that is almost impossible to remove once wrapped around a weapon. Seemingly able to stretch at will, this wrapping contains 8 sockets for gems of a magical nature. Once attached to a non-magical weapon, this attachment allows for the enhancement of the weapon's properties via magical gems, usually made by expert artificers. In other words, you may upgrade your weapon over time once you've wrapped this around it, but once you've wrapped it around a weapon, you will not be able to transfer it to a different weapon. Make sense? Cool. Let's talk about sapphires. This sapphire gives the kinetic enhancement modification. The swings of this weapon move with increased velocity. You may now consider your weapon magical, bypassing resistance to non-magical weapons. And most importantly, charge up. If you move more than 20 feet before attacking with this weapon, you will deal an additional 1d8 damage of the weapon's damage type. This effect is multiplied for each 20 feet moved before the attack. So if, for example, you move 60 feet, you may do 3d8 additional damage. This effect can only occur once per turn, so no hitting, running off, and running back when you hit your level 5. But I thought, I thought you could dash every turn. Turns out not. I'm assuming that is rather Bellows-vacated.
Very excited to figure that out, although it's going to take some time. So, back on the ship, perhaps.
Yes, I think attunement is a short rest for that, so yes it is.
Well, and it also specifically says it takes 8 hours of work.
Ah, correct. The wrapping is 8 hours of work. It is a short rest to add the sapphire, or vice versa. I don't know which one's which. One of them says 8 hours on it, right?
Yeah, the sapphire does.
So each time you want to add a gem, it takes 8 hours for the effect to mold into the weapon. The leather wrapping takes 30 minutes to stick on. So yes, indeed, it will not be present for you quite yet. At this moment, our lovely friend Brancus will expend some spell slots, so let me do that. I think a second level cure wounds? How are you guys looking? How bad? How much health are you missing?
Almost all of it.
I burned a couple.
Right.
I was untouched.
So I'm fine.
Actually, let me roll a con save instead. That's a much better idea. Yes, okay, 18 is more than half of 32, therefore he will maintain concentration on his beacon of hope, which is fucking marvellous, because then I can just say you gain 30 HP, Bellows.
Wonderful.
Which is a third level, I believe, yes, and then he's got a second level, so that'll be 8, 16...
I don't need any more after that.
So. 22, Arcorivos.
Sure. I'll take that using my own spells.
Yeah, that's 22 HP for you. And he will enact his Channel Divinity a second time, and somehow magically it will work out that you took 22 damage and healed 22 damage. I don't know how that worked, but I'm not going to punish you for going back across it. Go ahead and just leave.
Just leave.
So Brancus is going to stop here with you. And is going to say to you, I must thank you for your work. Naxilian, are you going to be long at this? Naxilian says, well, of course, I'm going to need at least 24 hours here, possibly more. I'm sure that you guys can occupy yourselves or something outside, can't you? Oh my goodness, look at me, I'll go ceiling, isn't it beautiful? he kind of wants to stay here forever. Brancus will eventually argue with him and say that he has a day to study before reporting his findings at Mechania, at which point, if he's allowed to return, he may return for a longer period of time. So, a day on the ship is what he is proposing. And with that, we come to our shit. I hadn't thought this through. Redo the thing. Bear with me a second. Sorry. I need to re-add this. Oh, I made a patron. I just didn't put anything on it. Shit. It is at this point he realized he truly fucked up. So we do that, and then I go over here, and oh my goodness, I've cast Agonaz's Scorcher. That's exciting, isn't it? How have I done that? And what I'm looking for is this, which is where we are making camp. Get me full sized. Bring me to size. Please, all the way. Please, all the way. Come on, snap to.
I'm just going to quickly grab a drink. Otherwise.
Please do. I am stuck trying to make things work.
Do the same thing then. My beer is empty.
Oh my fucking god. Fit. You are the right size. I made you the right size. Stop being difficult. I don't like white lines. Thank you. That is that. Cool. And now... Okay, as you arrive outside the cave, boom! There's a place outside a cave. That's what I was looking for. Fantastic. Are we all present and correct? Marvelous. Yes, you arrive outside to see where the camp has been set up, but I needed a page for it, and what I forgot to do was actually make the page for it. So if you wish to put your characters over here, please. Yeah, that's actually the entrance to the cave. But it's also like all those little crates are just sort of the camp bits. The airship is tethered a little way up here, so don't worry too much about that. But as you all sort of come out, and Brancus will escort Naxili and the rest of the way out in 24 hours' time. Sort of Chloe looks to you and, well, was that successful? I assume so, as you've left them behind.
Indeed. We accomplished everything we set out to.
Well, that's simply wonderful. Excellent. So,
And I acquired a little extra in the process.
Oh, indeed? Extra in the process?
Random bits of coin and mundane items, things of that sort.
Well, that is excellent. Well.
Yes, sir.
Sorry? Oh, I thought I missed something. At that point she'll say to you, well, we've made camp here, we might as well take a little bit of rest and relaxation, and we're going to Macarnius, but I haven't given much thought as to where we were headed afterwards. Have any of you?
Well, any job offers after we make this delivery to Fizbin or Foosball, whatever his name is?
Fizgill, indeed. Well, the most important delivery, of course, is Brancus and Maxidian. We would like our pay. But after that, well, Fizgill's always interesting. I'd like to ask him about Seth. S3. He's, well, I can't help but feel that I might have been fobbed off a little bit. Ever since his upgrades to become a mechanic, he's become ever so clumsy. Perhaps he might offer some advice, and, well, indeed. After that, I'm not really sure. I know that there is a fellow in Macarnia who I've been meaning to assist at some point. Rohan, he's a werewolf. He's seeking a plateau, apparently, above the clouds, where one can take rest and see the moon. It's meant to be quite a beautiful view, and I know that he's paying well for it, but honestly, the trip to the plateau sounds incredibly dangerous. Perhaps I'm not quite ready to take that, but it is always an option. Otherwise, of course, we can see what maps we can turn up at Lysa's place, and so they can find something interesting, somewhere to go.
Oh, never hurts.
Go on. I'll let you finish.
I was just going to say, it never hurts to pick up a few treasure maps, you know?
And then she turns
it. A few simple pulls.
My god! What is that? Coming towards us. And as you look over, there is a huge airship. Oh, there's two of them. Oh. Fuck me. Look at that. There is a huge airship coming towards you all. And it begins to hover sort of slightly above the air. Above the air, yes, above the ground. Perhaps at a 20, 30 feet up. At this point, I think a history check is in order. Probably from all of you, I think. Arkorivos, of course, has a wonderful memory and is the most likely to remember. Elmore wasn't paying any attention.
Elmore forgets his name, apparently, yeah.
Yeah, me too. I'm not even paying attention. I'm not sure the airship is even there.
Felix, did you make a history check for me?
Then,
unfortunately, although you're sure you've seen this ship before, you can't exactly recall where it came from. And at this moment, a woman jumps down from the ship. Now, I've got to be really careful to make sure I hand you the right thing, otherwise we're going to have some really interesting situations. So let me jump here. I think this will allow you to make notes without giving you my notes. Ugh! She jumps down, a drow! She has a shotgun in either hand, and she leaps down, and then it seems that we have a small problem here. She turns to her crewmates. We have been beaten, Tizzy Punch. Never good. She looks to you all, and to whom do I have the pleasure of addressing?
We are the crew of the, Crimson Rose? Something Rose?
Scarlet Rose?
Scarlet Rose.
Scarlet Rose, that's it. The Scarlet Rose.
I'm surprised you haven't heard.
Oh, the Scarlet Rose. Cleo Kirkland, no? Yeah. She is known for taking people to mediocre jobs to do mediocre things. What brings you here? It's a dangerous cave, from what I have heard.
Perhaps within the realm of our mediocrity.
Simple rock enthusiasts.
Within the realms of our mediocrity. I like that line. Unfortunately, I think that you have probably managed to extract the orbs that I was looking for, no?
Most likely.
Oh, what a damned tragedy. I had plans for that orb. I'm sorry, my new friends, but I may simply have to take it from you. And with that, her friends will leap down, and I'm afraid this is going to be a slow process. So, first of all, jumping down is a Vidalcan in a suit that appears to crackle with lightning. He appears to be the pilot of the ship. And I think that should have just popped up.
Garvakin. Yep.
Garvakin, yes. Next in line is... Oh, sorry, he's not the pilot at all. He's just an artificer. He's been some mechanic. Next, jumping down, or should I say hovering in mid-air after he's jumped out, appears to be the pilot. This is Arik, Storm Sorcerer. Next in line is a mercenary. Who appears to have a gun in either hand and a strange robe of sort of deep black over his leathers. He appears to be human. And finally, a strange looking... I think Arkorivos have recognized this to be an android. But he also looks like the Plague Doctor. He drops down with his sort of mystical lanterns in hand.
It looks like something from Bloodborne.
A strange holy symbol with him. And Jacqueline looks at you and you have the pleasure of addressing the Black Jackals. Hand over the orb or we shall have to fight.
Elmore's going to look over at his friends and be like, is this lady serious?
It's quite uncouth.
Yeah.
Felix just kind of gives like a coy wave.
And Chloe looks to you all and... We cannot afford to lose this job. You're simply going to have to defend us.
Very well.
And for the sake of expediency, I'm going to remove the ship. It's hovering up there somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I believe this dude is in the front. There you go. They do that sort of formation as they all surround their leader. They are all in the token there, right? You can all see them. See them all. Fantastic.
I can't. I think they're just too far away.
Yeah, they're too far from me. But if I move a little closer, I can see them all.
Is that better?
Yeah,
we can see them. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Okay. Fantastic. Just bear with me a second. Sorry. There is no way of setting this up in advance without ruining things. So over here, Brandy, I'm gonna move you guys up a step if you don't mind, because I don't particularly feel like putting them in boxes. Is Cleo and is S3. Perhaps Nabrak as well. Sarge is of course on the ship, sort of keeping it protected and manning it, and Lorelei couldn't be bothered to leave the bedroom. Sorry, not Sarge, Yacht, you haven't met Sarge yet. My apologies. So, at this point, are you willing to defend your goods?
Yeah.
You better believe.
Okay, go ahead and roll the initiative with advantage, please. That is you deciding to attack them, not the other way round.
Thank God, that's another natural one. Into another natural one.
Oh, that's unfortunate for you.
What is this?
Felix was distracted. Where are we?
Ooh, bellows.
Rolled 2 10s, the most average thing I could possibly do.
Okay, Elmore, I believe you're up first. Sorry, was everybody's initiative in? Arcorvos, yours seems to have gone down.
It should be 13.
Yeah, I thought that. Felix got 2 2s. Sure, Bellows, a 25, right?
No, I have 15.
Oh, it's adding them correct. Up. Right,
oh,
sorry,
yeah,
I see.
That's weird. Okay, so that's why.
Mine strangely didn't add it. Add it up.
No, mine was correct before.
Yes, yours didn't add it, and Bellows doubled for some reason. Yes, 10 plus 10 plus 5, weirdly. Cool, so that is now correct. Fantastic! Elmore.
Yes.
It is you who is going to be beginning. And it's just one more thing. And then I am here for completion. Where's my music? Too many things at once. Sadness. There we go. You're up, Elmo. Do you have any questions? Because I will allow you to sort of make an insight as to who's who and what's what and what might be dangerous or not.
Well, my first question is actually going to be, are we taking the, like, are we gaining the benefits of the level up?
Yes.
For this fight?
Yes, 100%. So if you need to take a moment to do that, we could take a short break if you guys need a moment to do that. Would that be helpful? At that point, I could have prepped on the damn break.
Very, very briefly. Yeah, yeah. Like a 2 minute, 3 minute for me.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be long.
There isn't really much for me to...
Okay, we'll take...
Do it. Just a couple minutes.
We'll take a minute or two.
Okay.
Yes, I think that's probably for the best. I really could have prepped that battle on that screen. Hey. But, well, no, because even then, like, they wouldn't have been there originally, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Welcome back! We are ready for an epic fight with what hopefully will be a rival mercenary group. Unless they kill us or we
kill them. If they survive.
Yes, indeed. Well, so they've leapt down and they've said that they're going to take these, the orb from you, which was the purpose of your job. Elmore, you are up. Did you have any questions regarding the enemies?
No, I mean, you were quite descriptive with their intro, so I think I'm satisfied with the info.
The only thing I perhaps didn't stress is the guy at the front is wearing a huge metal suit that is sort of producing light.
Crackling. Yeah. I assumed it was because of some sort of, yeah.
And I did move them back on purpose.
Okay. Question on the terrain. Is this a tree, like a huge tree to the south of us?
Is there a tree to the south of you? Here?
Like here. Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
That's a tree.
Okay.
It should be quite clear, right? Oh, wait. Yeah. Is it? Oh, there's no dynamic lighting here, right? You can see the whole map, correct?
No, there is dynamic lighting. Oh. It says if I'm in.
Yes, but there is no.
We can't see them.
No, but my point is there's no blocks.
There's no walls.
Oh, there's no walls. Yeah, okay, cool.
Nothing blocking inside, but we still have limited sight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the intention is to hide somewhere in this large brushed tree area.
Okay.
But I don't think that I can make it far enough to the trunk.
I'm afraid I am going to make you walk around this rock, right?
Which rock? Are we
talking about? Let me just draw here.
When you stood on.
You could probably just hide where you are.
Oh, got you.
Do you see what I mean? In fact, I'm going to do that just so that you guys see that is delineated as like... This is a reason why I put you here, basically. It is there for a reason. So please go ahead and use it.
So I will use hide then as a bonus action. If I can, from where I'm standing.
You want to hide first?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
I'm going to hide. Did you need a stealth check?
That depends. Are you going to immediately attack?
I was going to ready my attack, actually, and wait for one of my companions to approach.
Okay.
First. I know that I get advantage, but
make your stealth check, but just keep that number to yourself because I'm sure I'll ask more than once anyway.
Okay.
Cool. Okay. Does that conclude your turn?
Ooh. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Brilliant. That is time for Jackson. Jackson will step. How will he step up? Does he need to? 40. Yes. Jackson will maneuver himself over here.
It's more comfortable that you used my spot to measure.
No, because you were just the center of the group. I can move one more spot, actually. He's going to maneuver over here. I think that's right. Yes, he can shoot all of you. That's good. And he shall draw his two pistols and take a couple of shots at you. That's going to be one to hit Arcolimos. That's a 14 to hit you. And one to hit Bellows. That's a 16 to hit you.
That hits.
Frightening.
Especially because I didn't get a chance to rage yet.
Damage.
How much?
He has the sharpshooter ability.
21?
Deadeye, yes. 21.
Jesus, half my new health.
Well, just be glad he couldn't sneak attack you. and at the end of his turn... Oh, he can't move back. Oh, in that case, he's going to... No, wait.
Did the pistol attacks take into account the -5 on the sharpshooter?
Yes. That is why it's okay. +4 to hit you. Wow. Bellows, you are up. Don't worry, that's not going to happen every turn. Fear not. Jamal was going, you can't give him a sharpshooter feat. I was going, I fucking well can. Watch me. good luck. Bellows, you're up.
Well, eventually leave those lightning bastards to me, but I'm going to hit this man on the way over there. And I will rage and use my 35, which should be 1, 15, 15, 20, 20, 20, 30. I can get to here. And why is that coming up in front of my face? And I will hit this guy.
Shit. Yep, I did not take that into account. Go ahead, take
and
your
I'm
turn.
Angry, so why not? I'm actually angry. Like, his rage isn't supposed to be anger, but he keeps getting angry. So reckless it is. Mm-hmm. Oh, that doesn't matter. Not when you roll a 1 and a 3. That's my turn.
Give me the numbers, please, if you don't mind.
8? No, sorry, it's +6 now. 9.
9, okay. Not as far off as you might consider. That's all
okay,
I'm going to say.
But very cool. Seldom is there an AC below 10, so but anyway.
Yeah. And is that your turn complete?
That's everything. Rage is my bonus action. Run over there was all my movement, and attacking him was my completely worthless action.
Brilliant. I love that for you. Jacqueline, where...
Can I take my ready to action?
What were you readying for? The first attack?
For one of my companions. Yeah, the first attack from one of my companions.
Right, sorry, I misunderstood. Like, I thought it was the first time that somebody came into range of you. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
I think they were all in range in the first place.
Yep, go ahead.
I'm going to retaliate against this mysterious rogue, and I assume I get to roll it at advantage. I'm not sure.
Yeah, of course. You have an ally with him. Wait, you don't get advantage for that, do you?
For being
advantage
hidden.
Would be from being hidden, not from...
Yeah.
Oh, from being hidden. Yes, 100%. Yes, sorry, okay. I have done my perception check on that.
And so I'm always all going to pump my... or utilize my sharpshooter feat. Mm-hmm. And so that'll be a 18 to hit.
See, Jamal, if they can do it, I can do it. Yes, right. An 18 will most definitely hit. Go ahead and give me your damage.
Okay, here we go. So that'll be a 13 plus 3, 16 plus 10 for 26 damage.
And this is why we do damage as enemies. He is wounded. He's looking in a rough spot. As you would if you had have hit yourself, basically. yeah.
And, that'll be it for me then.
Okay, cool. Of course, because that wasn't actually your turn, yes. Yes. Okay, Jacqueline will draw her two weapons. And she will move up here. I think... Oh, no, that blocks her line of sight. She'll go here. Arcolibos, the first shot will be at you. Oh, actually.
Right on.
Yeah. That is a 25 to hit you.
Oh, that'll hit.
That's 11.
I'm going to silvery barbs that, I think.
Okay.
Ooh. Very nice.
And I'll
play
just
a, I'll play a shrieking note to disrupt her aim.
That is a 16 to hit instead.
16 will miss.
Shut that guitar up!
I'm a shield.
Fuck. Goodness me, you're annoying. And with that, she will shoot with her offhand. That's a 26
right.
to hit.
26 will hit.
But you've reduced the damage by a lot. That's 10.
Alright.
10 piercing, specifically.
Mm-hmm.
Arcolibos, it is your turn.
Alright, well, with this guy wounded, I'm going to try to give him a Tasha's Mind Whip.
Oh, lovely.
Let's see if I can
that.
Finish him off with some psychic
is
damage.
Is that a wisdom or a dex? It's intelligence.
Intelligence.
Yeah, I remember now. That's an 11 save.
Hey.
All right. 11 psychic damage.
Mm-hmm. Does that have a secondary effect on it?
So on his next turn, he can't take reactions until the end of his next turn. On his next turn, he must choose whether he moves, takes an action, or a bonus action.
Yeah,
it's only one of the three.
Mm-hmm. Nice, we like that. Any bonus action for you?
So, Psychometabolic Surge.
Beautiful.
To heal a little bit, because I did some psychic damage. And I think I'm actually going to kind of take cover in here and hope that they don't just fireball us all while we're in this
little hole. I wouldn't do that. Come on.
So,
Cool. Does that conclude your turn?
I have a few of them to have line of sight on me as possible.
And he says, I wouldn't do that to you. Jacqueline will take a legendary action to reload her revolver. So maybe I would do that to you. But that is all she can do. And then that leads us to Doc. Doc is just over here, and he shall cast Darkness upon himself.
Mm.
That's really annoying. It does the center. Do the center thing. Oh, fuck it. We'll just put it there. Okay, that's great. He'll cast Darkness upon himself and others. And... oh, shit. I fucked that up. Man, I screwed up the sheet. No bonus action. Cool. That leads us to... Oh, God. They're all taking their turn around, aren't they? I specifically tried to avoid that. That'll lead us to Carvacan. Carvacan can't see. And he is also... behind this.
Carvacan, are any of our allies participating?
Allies? Sort of. You'll see that in a moment.
Okay.
Okay. That's why I went, oh shit, when Brandy realized she was 45 feet away from our... injured barbarian. Carvacan will run up to hit you, Bellos. That is that is a nat 20 on the first hit.
Oh shit.
Awesome.
He's hitting you with an arm blade, a sword attached to his arm. That is 11 slashing damage, halved to 5.
Okay.
And as a bonus action, he will attempt to lightning shock you, which is a melee spell attack. Oh, that's another 26. But that's not a nat 20. I have to roll the 8 here. Oh, spiffing. That is one lightning damage, though you may not take reactions until your next turn.
I'm resistant. Does it go to 0? I can't remember.
Yep, 0 is fine. Half of 1 rounded down is most definitely 0, so no damage. But you cannot make... take reactions until the start of its next your next turn.
Okay,
at this point Brandy will look around. Is anybody hurt?
I think
is yelling yes a reaction.
she can't do anything about you, I'm afraid.
Mildly, but yes,
she will move up to you, and she can do this infinitely, so she's quite fine with that. And she will use her healer's kit to stab you with a needle.
Alright.
That is 9 healing for Arcoribus.
Alright, that'll put me back up to full at 25.
Okay, S3 fix it, we'll look around. He will cast Mending on Elmore. Which is actually him taking the help action. I don't know whether I can help you have advantage without being able to reach the enemies, though. I have to look at the help action in combat. The creature you aim gains advantage, right?
Yeah, you've got to be next to them.
I think the creature, right? Enemy. Yeah, he has to be next to you. Enemy. Yeah, not next to the enemy.
No. In the combat version, you have to be next to the enemy.
It is next to the enemy, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Unless you're like a mastermind rogue.
Hmm. Okay, yeah, he is not a mastermind in any way whatsoever.
Can he reload my gun for me?
Ooh, can he reload your gun for you? Let's give him an intelligence check.
That's amazing.
Yes! He can! Imagine that!
Yes. Sethi, get over here!
Okay.
Take this bullet!
Nabrak will give the next person in range, which is probably Felix, a d4 of lightning on his next hit. And Chloe will tell you all to get on with it, because she don't do things. that brings us to Arik. Savage. Yeah, let's do that. An orb. Oh, no. Okay, first of all, he's going to fly upwards, but I'm going to move him out as well. Just so that you guys know he's not in darkness. He flies up out of the darkness, and he raises his hands, and two orbs of lightning cascade towards... can he see you?
Oh, he can't see me.
Yeah, he can. Two orbs of lightning cascade towards Elmore and Felix, as he twin spells his chromatic orb.
He's stealing my moves.
He's stealing my moves! Oh no, you can't twin spell it again.
Because I can.
Question. I took the skulker feat, so in theory, I did come out of hiding after making the shot.
Oh, really? You have shot through the and skulker?
Yeah.
How?
Remember, I started with one because of the race. And then
you started with one because of your race. I'd forgotten about that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're still hidden?
Yes, technically.
Sorry, Bellos.
I mean, I don't mind taking the hit.
It's what I'm here for.
Okay, one to Bellos. That's an 8 to hit you for a natural 1. And one to Felix. That's an 18 to hit you, Felix.
I will shield that with a fiery shield.
Beautiful. His twin chromatic orbs seem to do nothing. At this point, Jacqueline Lavache will turn to him and stop trying to show off and aim properly. Try again. And she will take a legendary action to command an ally to make an attack.
Damn.
Yes. And he can only cantrip with that. So he will attempt to frostbite Felix. Con save, please. Felix. Is that him right? Sorry?
15.
All I'm hearing is teen.
15.
15. That is a success. Nothing happens. Felix, you are up.
Cool. I am going to spend one sorcery point to twin spell chromatic.
Fancy that. Who are you aiming at?
Okay, so I will be aiming one at this guy.
Justin. Jackson, yeah. Sorry, the injured.
Jackson, and then one at the leader.
Mm-hmm.
This one.
Yeah.
Okay, so the one at Jackson. Oh. That's a 22.
Yep. That'll hit.
Okay. Ooh, nice. 19 fire damage.
Okay, say goodbye to Jackson.
Yeah, bye, Jackson.
You now can work out why I've been singing, I'm going to Jackson all fucking day.
Jackson, here I come.
And then the next one for the leader.
For Jacqueline Lavache.
Sorry, I will get the names. That's a 19.
A 19? She doesn't like that. Go ahead, give me some damage.
Oh, sorry, Jackie.
I nearly called her Jackie Lavash, to be fair.
9 fire damage.
9 fire damage. Cool. She likes that. Okay. Does that conclude your turn?
Surely does.
She will take her final legendary action to reposition herself within these trees behind her friend. Elmore, you're up.
Okay, Elmore is going to... we agreed that Sethri... reloaded the gun successfully.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
You reloaded your
gun. I'm gonna take another sharpshooter shot at this artificer here that's standing next to Bellos.
Okay.
Menacingly.
That's called vacuum.
17 to hit.
No, that'll miss. I'm afraid.
Ooh,
his suit is very well armored.
Indeed. And with a bonus action, I am going to play a healing melody for my good friend Bellos, and
I love that
healing word here.
I thought you were gonna
play for a five healing.
Yep, beautiful. Does that conclude your turn, Elmo?
Yes, I think so.
Okay. Jackson will make his death save. I want to roll this to you guys. Where can I do that? Here.
Ooh. There you go.
Jackson's gonna stand up with 1 HP. Imagine that. Full disclosure, they're rolling death saves for a specific reason, but I don't... Yeah, we'll get to that when we get to that. Well, we're gonna...
still got the mind whip.
He now takes his turn, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does occur at the beginning of his turn. He's still under the effect of the Tasha's mind whip.
He will bonus action disengage and wonder why I deleted his token. Like, why did I do that to him? That wasn't very nice, was it?
He can't move.
Oh, he can't move at all?
If he bonus action disengage, he can bonus action or move or take an action.
He can only make
do more than one thing.
Okay.
That means he stands up, that's a movement. So if he stands up, that's the only thing he can do.
Yeah, I think he's just going to skip his turns.
Otherwise, he stays prone, and Bellows can cave his head in with a wrench.
Does anybody know where I put the token? That would be really nice. There we go. Like, stop doing that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to give him a little marker like this, okay? So he's not dead. So he rolled an at 20, which is not... I really didn't want to do that, to be honest. So I'm going to actually leave him at 0 HP. He is unconscious, okay? Even though he rolled an at 20, he's unconscious. Yeah.
Fair enough.
I just wanted to make it not a success. Bellows, you're up. And if you reach towards him, Jacqueline will turn to you, and if you are going to make this a battle to the death, then it may be bad for all of us.
Oh, sorry, James, just retroactively, I need to roll a 1d4 for that extra lightning damage.
You
on
do,
Jacqueline.
You do. Please do.
That's two.
Cool. She'll take that. Yes, but she will just tell Bellows that if you make it a battle to the death, she will join in and accept that, but it may be more dangerous for the all of you.
I'm perfectly happy to crush this other fool.
That's what I like to hear. Okay, cool. So I'm now going to take his token out of the fight, and we'll just say he's unconscious. He's done for, okay? Right. Cool. I just didn't want to do that on his turn, because it didn't make any sense.
Yeah. Great. Reckless hit this lightning guy.
Mm-hmm.
I guess there were two lightning guys, but you know which one you're hitting. Oh, Lord. I know he's got high AC, so it's not even going to be close. 12.
Yeah. That does...
But I will, in the process of attempting to hit him very hard, I have tried to make it easier for the next person to hit him by help on that there, and then I will run off for a bit.
Okay.
I can go all the way down like here. And I will.
Fantastic, nice. We love that.
And that's not using the dash, that's just my movement. But you can opportunity attack if you like, if he has a way to do that.
He does, he has an arm blade.
It'll be a straight roll, because I was reckless.
Ah, yes, of course it will. Well done. That's a 22.
Of course it hits.
5 slashing damage. Half to 2.
Alright, but advantage on the next attack against him.
Yep. That brings us to Jacqueline Lavache. She will be glad to have her normal stuff back. She only reloaded one gun. So she shall take... you see her sort of double-click something on the back of the gun. Can I not ping this? How annoying. I cannot. Can I? Yes, there we go. She readies her revolver and takes 2 shots at once. So this is 1 attack roll, 2 hits. And that will be at... I think that'll be at Bellows. Let me just confirm that. Yes, that will be at Bellows. So that is, I'm afraid, a 25 to hit you.
Okay.
That might hurt.
Sorry, I'm going to still rebarb that. Okay.
That's fine. That is a 13 to hit you.
That does not.
We're loving that silvery barbs. Beautiful.
Worth it.
Who's giving advantage to what to where?
Let's give...
Sorry, I should have asked that the last time as well, but I forgot.
Let's give Bellows advantage.
And his next hit. Lovely. Yes. We like that. She looks at you and that is annoying. Stop playing that guitar. She stopped
being
French.
But he's so good.
She stopped being French. Don't know when that happened. Arcanibos, you're up.
All right.
You must not play the guitar.
I'm going to use a second level slot to summon 2 wisps.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, summon a wisp. And kind of put them between us and them, so they're nice things that one might want to shoot. And then let me double check my bonus action. It's telekinetic shove, only has a range of 30 feet, so I can't shove anyone. I'm going to my wisp will fire at the artificer dude there.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see here. Where did I have? Oh, there we go. So, Wisp attack. There we go. We got a 16, and we got a 16.
Nice.
Either of those hit?
Sorry, you're trying to hit this dude?
Yeah.
The first attack will be an advantage, so I'll say that was a 16. Do you want to attack with the other one?
Sure.
Because of the help action.
Roll worse. 9.
Yeah, unfortunately that'll miss.
Alright.
Cool. Does that conclude your turn?
Yep.
Jacqueline will take a legendary action to reload her gun. And that'll bring us to our Plague Master. 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. Okay, and he shall cast Silence. Because he's real nice. Bear with me, I'm looking for it. Ugh. Cool. He'll stick that over there.
Alright.
The specifics of this spell are...
I tried to get your attention.
Yeah, there is no specifics of that. There is no save, no nothing. Inside there, you are both deaf and cannot cast a spell, including a verbal component.
Mm-hmm.
That's real nice of him. Jacqueline Navash will take a legendary action to reload her pistol, and that will bring us to Carvacan. Carvacan is completely confused because everybody's fucked off. He will move up here. 5, 10. Oh, he can see you. That's good. 15, 20, 25, 30. 25, move the silence. Okay. 25. No, I did not want to do that. Sorry. I'm really not good at this. That was trying to say to back. There we go. 30. Is that all his movement speed? It is. Oh, it's not even that. He's only got 25. Sure, he's going to swing at your wisp, I'm afraid.
All right.
that is a... 15 to hit?
That will miss.
What?
It has an AC of 17.
Alright, it'll miss twice. Mm-hmm. Okay, Brandy waves her hands around. S3 will look at L and sort of shrug his shoulders. And make his intelligence check. I'm gonna go with no. This turn. That's a no. And that will bring us to Arik. Arik will... Oh, Nebra can do something, I guess. Yeah, he will do the same as he did last time and give the 1d4 of lightning damage to Felix. As this is technically a mechanical tool he has. Arik is up and he is... What? That is not the page I'm looking for. There we go. I'm going to do speak with animals? I'm really not sure what to do here. As a bonus action here, he has swirling gusts of wind, of elemental air surrounding him. And he shall fly over here. And then he shall throw some lightning at... Can I even see you? No, he's going to throw it at the wisp. That is a 17 to hit.
That'll hit.
3d8 of fire damage at them. Oh, sorry, I wrote to myself. 17.
Alright. Which one did it hit?
The only one you can see. This one.
Okay. Right.
This one is currently in darkness. Yeah.
Alright.
Okay.
It is destroyed.
Oh, okay. Cool, that works.
Felix. 17 fire damage.
Yeah, Felix, you're up.
Okay, I'm going to use my 20 feet movement speed to get out of the silence.
Can you see in darkness?
Where's the darkness?
That black sphere around the plague.
I don't see it's darkness.
Yeah, I was just going to ask. I thought he got rid of darkness to do silence because the darkness went away.
Ah, I see. No. I thought that you would be able to see the aura on him, but I guess not. Okay. I will take off the aura and I will cast darkness instead. It's not actually darkness, the spell. That's why It didn't go away, but it's also darkness.
Yeah, when we went across the lava earlier and Miyaga pointed out you can make an aura around a thing, it didn't show on our screens. So I guess that doesn't work that way, unfortunately.
Okay. It's an aura around him. Oh, it was the right size. Hold on. Why did it... There we go. It's just really annoying because it's not attached to him. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, then I won't run that way then.
Well, Josh, you can see where it ends, right? So you can go that way. You can just
show the curve. Like, I suppose.
No, but you won't be able to see. Yeah.
I'll risk it all.
You can go that way if you want to.
Yeah, I'll go up here. And then I will spend another sorcery point.
Yep.
To twin spell some chromatic orbs. And one's going to this guy.
Yep.
And then the other's going to this guy.
Okay, go ahead, give me two attack rolls.
Okay. That's 24.
Yep, that'll hit.
Cool.
I need the second attack roll.
14 fire damage.
I need the second attack roll.
And the second one. 16.
Oh, this is really hard for me because you didn't say which you were targeting with which.
Oh, sorry.
And there's one way in which you hit both, and there's one way in which you hit neither.
I choose the one where I hit. Oh.
Yeah, go ahead. Give me the damage for both. That's fine. So 14 for the first one. That's absolutely fine. You said fire damage, of course. And the second one is hitting Arik. Yep, go ahead.
That's 16.
Yeah, I'll give you the benefit of the doubt on that. I'm assuming you would target the person nearest you first. That's what logic I went with. But I think you one went there and one went there. So, either way. That's fine. Jacqueline will take her third legendary action. Oh, sorry, any bonus action out of you?
No, I don't think
so. Jacqueline will take her third legendary action to command our friend here to attack you. He cannot move with that, so he is going to take his ranged attack at you, which is a spark. That is a 24 to hit you.
That sure does.
Okay, you will take 10 lightning damage. I apologize. And on the subject of lightning damage, can you give me your d4 of lightning damage for the first target you hit?
4.
Okay, and I'm going to apply that to the guy that's not wearing the sparkling suit of lightning. But please try and be specific with what you're doing with your shit.
Yeah,
that's all right. Elmore, you're up. Wait, did I just skip somebody? No, I didn't.
No, I don't think so.
No, Elmore, you're up.
So Elmore is going to action reload.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. And I think he's going to come out of hiding a little bit here.
Yep.
Sorry. I'm just going to measure out. Sure. I'm going to come out around cave here, and if I can stand here, I will.
Yes, that's fine. You're leaning back against a rock.
And bonus action dash, and I'll come into the brush.
Okay, sorry, can you go back there? Moving up this hill.
What spell did that artificer use, and did it not involve a verbal component?
Oh, of course.
He's in the silence.
Thank you, Josh Hill, 10 health. He was unable to hear the command to attack, and therefore did nothing. Even if he could cast a spell while in silence, it doesn't actually require a verbal component. It's an item on his wrist, but he can't hear, so why would he attack? Sorry, Elmore, the first 10 feet of that is difficult terrain.
Okay. In that case...
You can still get to, like, here, but... Yeah, exactly.
10, 15, 20...
Yeah, that's great. And then you're hidden in there. So, yeah. That is full obscuring vision, so you won't be able to see out, nor will they be able to see in. Yeah.
Gotcha.
From how it is right now. Thick brush. Does that conclude your turn, Elmore?
That does.
Bellows.
And I'm quickly just going to use the bathroom.
Okay, cool. Bellows, you're up.
So... The woman in charge, she's been shooting people or just yelling at people to do
things?
She's
shot people and been yelling at people.
Yeah,
and didn't she say to me, don't hit my guy who's down or I'll get in this fight?
No, she said if you want to make it a fight to the death, that could be bad for both of us.
Right. So it's not like she said...
She's not going to kill you either.
I still don't like her, but it's
interesting
in the fight. I think what I'm going to do is I would run directly at her, but I'm going to run right into the guy that I don't know is there.
Yep.
And use that to justify hitting him.
Great. Because, love that. Love that.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm on.
And you are most definitely being reckless, so.
I don't have to be reckless because I have the advantage from Silvery Barbs.
What I'm saying is you are most definitely being reckless. So take the advantage regardless. This is my logic of it is you're swinging so wildly.
But presumably but it's a straight roll because I'm in darkness.
It's a straight roll, but you will not be attacked with advantage.
Because I'm not reckless.
Yeah.
That's going to be an 18 to hit.
That will most definitely hit.
I don't know what I'm hitting here, but I don't like it. So I'm hitting it as hard as I can, which is 13 bludgeoning damage.
Indeed. That is bludgeoning damage? You notice that your weapon seems to hit more resoundingly than you thought.
Wow.
And not only that, but he loses concentration on silence. Fantastic. That's what we like to see.
Oh, and the darkness is not a concentration issue?
No.
I see. So I can't go, that's what's in here. I still don't know.
No, I would tell you that you could see what was pulsing on his chest, but unfortunately it's dark.
So I was there. Wait. I'm just gonna, oh boy.
You keep going? Second.
Well, she shoots anyway, right?
Yeah.
I'm going to run right up to her.
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't even require my dash.
You will take an attack of opportunity with disadvantage, though, correct?
That's fine, yes.
Yeah, okay. I'm just confirming it's with disadvantage.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Doesn't matter whether I actually dash.
We're trying to learn our own things.
Right, so maybe I won't make it. But
13.
Does not hit.
Fantastic. That's what we like to see. You're right up in her face. Go ahead, bash a bitch.
I can't. I can't hit again.
Oh, of course you can't. Yeah, no. That's
no,
fine.
But
Did you hit it with that advantage?
I did.
He was a disadvantage
because
of
darkness, etc., etc. But I can tell Felix, if you want to hit this one and get the boss out of things, I'll make it a little easier for you. Up to you. But let's help on her.
Get me out of things, eh? Would be useful for you, no? And with that, can she do that? She will holster her guns and take the disengage action. Because she can't stow and draw her weapon in the same turn. And she shall attempt... That's a weird one, that, because this disengage only gives her 10 feet of... Well, I suppose you could take the traditional disengage action. Yeah, she'll do that. I don't think she's going to get any further away than this, though. Yeah, Bella, she's going to take, like, literally 10 feet away from you. Yep. And that'll conclude her turn. Arcorivos, you are up.
All right. Gonna move out. Sorry, I didn't mean to move that guy just yet. I'm gonna move out here, so I got a good line on this guy, and I'm gonna dip my tentacle into my little stein and flick it into the ground. Flick some glowy shit into the ground, and ectoplasmic chains are going to burst from the ground around this artificer, and he gets to make a dexterity saving throw as I cast Mage Chain. All right, so he is restrained.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, as a bonus action, just for the fun of it, I'm gonna shove him with my telekinetic feet.
Mm-hmm.
So he gets to make a strength saving throw.
Oh, hold on. There will be a second on that one. Okay, no, it's not that. There is an extra two. That's a 9. Sorry, not a 7.
Okay. Well, either way, still a fail. So I'm going to push him 5 feet away from me.
Oh, what the hell? Apparently you push the darkness.
I'm not pushing the darkness.
Why does that keep moving?
As much as I would like
to. Go away. Sorry, in which direction?
Away from me, so, you know.
I'm assuming not towards, not towards Felix. Take this enemy. cool.
Then my wisp will do stuff. It will have advantage because he is restrained.
It will.
Oh, look at that. AC 23.
That'll hit.
All right, 5 force damage.
Nice.
And that is... I'm going to move there. That's my turn.
Okay. Goodness me, this is not going to be a short fight, is it? Sorry. I need to cue up music.
I like him long.
I was expecting to do other things this session. That'll bring us to our little friend, Doc. I think he will summon a spiritual weapon. Just so that we can have more turns in this fight. I didn't mean to close that bum toot. Twitch, stop being so shit. Okay. If you say so. He'll go Samuna Mace. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 30. Oh, yeah, it's 60 feet. Okay, that's fine. He's going to attempt to bonk you on the head with it.
Alright.
That is a 24 to hit.
That'll hit.
Do we know this? Oh, yeah, I put it down here, didn't I?
Who's doing this to me?
The guy in the darkness.
Oh, okay. And he can see me. Okay.
You may assume he can see out of it, yes.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he probably wouldn't have cast it in the first place. Mm-hmm. that is 7 force damage.
Alright.
And then...
Can't say to retain concentration.
And then he shall, as a... Oh, that's also a bonus action? Really?
Ooh, that's funny.
Is Spare the Dying a bonus action? No, it's an action, right? Yeah, that's what I thought. He shall spare the dying... Is that a touch spell? It is. Never mind, he shall not do that. Josh, make a wisdom save. You maintain concentration, I see that. Cool. Loving that. Felix, make a wisdom save, please.
Day 20.
Fantastic, nothing happens. A gong rang out, but you ignored it because you weren't interested in that shit. Mr. Armblade is determined to get these wisps out the fight. So attack them he will. That is a 9 and a 9. Fuck me, you're useless.
Is he restrained still?
Oh, sorry, yeah, he restrained. Does he make a save at the end of his turn?
At the end of his turn.
Okay. Which is why you push him, obviously. He shall use those attack rolls on his spark. Once as he shoots from his gauntlet, they would be at disadvantage, but a 9 doesn't hit anything anyway. Cool, that ends his turn. Brandy will flap about a bit and go, I can't see Bellows! I'm sure he's injured! Wish he wouldn't run away so far. Whatever her voice is, completely forgotten that. I don't think any of them can do anything useful. Nabrak will give you a d4 of lightning on your next attack, Arcanibus.
Okay.
Okay, cool. And that'll lead us to Arik. Arik is out of first level spell slots, so he better do something interesting. Within 15 feet of you. Okay, he's going to move up here, and he is going to ask you to make a strength save, please, Felix.
Sure. I have a minus 2.
Okay.
That's 60.
A 16?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck off. That's nothing. Felix, you're up. I feel like Jacqueline should take a legendary action to say, at least somebody should do something to someone. This fight is going to go on forever.
Okay, so I will chromatic orb this person.
Okay. The sorcerer who's just aimed at you, yep.
Yep. That's a 18 to hit.
An 18 will hit, most definitely.
Nice.
Sorcerer battle.
Well, this one speaks 6 languages.
That's 15 fire damage.
And he can pilot an airship. He's also unconscious.
And then I will bonus action, use my last sorcery spell and sorcery point to regain that first level spell slot back.
Cool. Excellent usages. Does that conclude your turn?
Is he still flying when Felix knocked him out?
Yeah, he fell on the floor.
Okay.
Yeah. It hurt. He was only 10 feet above the ground, but still, it hurt.
Okay. That still failed death save.
Yeah, Jacqueline shall... Ooh, can she do that? Within 30 feet? No, she can't. That is not 30 feet in any realm, shape, or form. She'll realize she's isolated, and she will attempt to book it. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. She will...
Is this legendary?
Yeah, that's her legendary action. Okay, okay, she's repositioning. And Elmore, you're up. And she's also out of legendary actions now, so... For this
and
round.
She didn't go past me? I wasn't watching.
No, she did her absolute utmost to go round like this.
Figured that was fine.
Yes, Elmore, you're up.
So, question. Is this like a raised area here?
Only a little bit. It's like half a foot down. It's not difficult terrain.
It's not difficult terrain?
No, the water's not particularly... It looks pretty, but it's really not that running that fast. You can just... Yeah, it's all free movement.
Yeah, okay. So, I'm going to jut out over here. And I don't know if I can actually see Jacqueline.
If your straight line goes through the darkness, you can't see her.
It goes through.
Yeah.
And you're not so what I'll do then is I'm going to... I'm going to bonus action dash.
Mm-hmm.
And take another 30.
Yep.
To get behind, and assuming that I can have her in my sights,
I'm going
to take
an
attack with Boomcaster. It'll be at 16.
16 will miss, I'm afraid.
Oof. And that's it for me.
Okay. Not our carnivals. Bellows, you are up.
Okay, I am going to first... I keep switching to ruler. I need to switch back. I'm going to walk over here, and I'm going to hit her as recklessly as I possibly can.
Mm. Lovely.
For tasty. A 21 to
that
hit.
That most definitely hit.
Oh, not great damage, though. 9 bludgeoning damage. And I am
she's
going...
injured.
Okay. And I'm going to just say... tell these remaining fools to drag their friends out of here! And I'm going to run by...
give me a
persuasion
check on the way.
Okay, sure. I mean, I wasn't trying to make it an action or anything, but...
No, I know. But as a free action, you can speak. Let's see what she thinks of you.
I have, like, negatives on these things, so it's gonna be a 16.
Ooh! That's not a bad roll.
That's pretty good.
If it were intimidation, it would be 8. Myself? I mean, I think usually when you're intimidating, when you're trying to persuade someone after you've just cracked their brain with a chuckle.
I will tell you, even with the intimidation roll, it wouldn't have made any difference. I should look at you and, perhaps, but not yet, this is a lot of money for me.
And as I pass this guy. All right, Phoenix, good work. Finish this lightning idiot. Help action on him and move back into here. Where maybe people can help me a little bit if they want to. Because I heard them yelling out, he's too far away and I can't help him.
Yep.
So he can take an opportunity attack on me if he has the reaction. I don't know.
He is restrained. I'm going to say no.
Ah, cool. Yeah.
I
think he can, but I'm going to say no. Because it's already a disadvantage to hit you as well. So, yeah, no. Okay, it is the turn of Jacqueline Levache. She's going to try it. Attack of opportunity for the Wisp if it gets one.
Yep. There we go. Actions.
And attack of opportunity for Bellows.
Wisp got a 17.
That'll miss, I'm afraid.
Off the top of my head, have no idea how Reckless doesn't interact with this, does it?
No.
Yeah, it's on your turn, yeah.
And it's a nat one.
Oh, fantastic. And she will attempt to grab Cleo and put a gun to her head.
Oh, shit.
She will turn to you all and give us the orb and this can end peacefully.
This is exactly the tactic that you dissuaded us from, dropping your downed ally. You are a filthy liar.
Do make an insight check. I think both you and... Bellows, as you're right next to this, both of you may make an inside check.
Nah. Got a 15.
Mm. Same here.
Seeing the steely look in Cleo's eyes and the way she's holding the gun, like, she's holding it to her head, but she's not got her finger over the trigger. She's got her finger, like, outside the trigger cage. You think that perhaps she wouldn't go through with what she's saying? And as players, you may consider that she hasn't pulled the trigger already. Okorivos, it is your turn. And actually, go ahead and give me a intimidation check, I think, for what you said. I think intimidation. Is that fair?
Yeah.
You know, check. You called her a liar. I don't know what a...
Them's fighting words.
Yeah, she didn't care.
I mean, you know, she was like, hey, no. How dare you attack helpless people? And then she's like, you know what I'm going to do? Attack the helpless person.
Indeed. Well, she is the person to the death, you know?
She accused us of being.
Indeed, quite probably.
So, let me see. Well, in defense of my captain, I'm going to go for the restrained artificer, but I think the captain is going to take priority here. So I am going to summon a little thunder orb and fire it at Jacqueline. Mm-hmm. So, let's go thunder, because thunder's fun. There we go. AC 26.
Nice. Go ahead and give me some damage. What is the damage type?
Garbage. Thunder.
Thunder.
Five thunder damage with 1, 3, and a 1 on those 3 die 8.
That is not good.
That was horrible. And bonus action, psychometabolic search. And then my wisp is going to go after the restrained dude.
Advantage.
So it will have, there we go. Advantage. There we go. A 22.
That'll hit.
All right. 6 force damage to him.
Nice. He appears to be okay.
All right.
I'm
just going to move over here in front of, or by Felix to just be fun. And that's my action economy.
Okay.
I'm done doing stuff.
Doc is going to move. Oh. Yeah, I can't move the darkness, but whatever. The darkness is moving with him. Hmm. He's going to move right up here. And the darkness moves with him. Bellows, if you want, you can swing as you feel somebody move away.
I mean, I can't do it again. I've already used my reaction.
Oh, you've already used your reaction?
Yeah.
Okay. The captain leaves with him as he steps back. You may assume that she took a legendary action to do that. Although technically, no, she... interesting. Okay, hold on. I've got to move that back. She can't take a legendary action on someone else's turn. That leads us to... Oh, then she will take a legendary action to book it over here.
Huh.
Not realizing she stepped out the darkness into somebody else's view. Kalvaken... will move up here and will make a swing at...
Was he still restrained?
Oh, he's still restrained. Yeah, you're right. They'll stop doing that. I need to put... I've got these damn markers for a reason. Put one on him. Like, for goodness sake, he is... I don't know. Where is a restrained button? Oh, fuck it. That looks cool. I don't think it's got anything to do with restrained, but we'll take it as it is.
I should look at it and be like, why does he have that? Oh, yeah.
He will look into the darkness and he will... fire a catapult randomly. Dex save, please. Bellows.
And I guess I can't see it, so it's not a...
Oh no, by all means, you cannot. I'm afraid you are in the darkness.
That's a fail. I mean, it's going to be a 4 plus whatever my thing is. Nope. 6 total.
That is 7 bludgeoning damage. I think that's bludgeoning damage, right? Catapult?
Probably.
Yeah, catapult is.
It is, yeah. 7 bludgeoning damage, so you can hop it to 3. Yep. And that'll conclude Karvakan's turn. Brandy is going to bravely walk into this darkness. Bellows, where are you?
I'm over here. Surely you can hear me.
I'm sure she can. You will receive 11 HP in healing as she stabs you with a healer's kit. Eric is unconscious. Felix, you're up.
Okay, I am gonna move on over here and I'm gonna yell out over to Jackie. Hey Jackie, I've got an orb for you. I will chromatic orb her.
I love it. I've got an orb for you, he says.
That's a 19 to hit.
And it is chromatic and it will hit.
Aye, do it. Roll better damage than I did.
Yeah.
Not great. That's a 10 fire damage.
Shit, Jesus.
Yeah, not great.
Alright, however, she is severely wounded. And at this point, does that conclude your turn?
Yeah, it does.
Should say. Okay. We will not make the mistake of challenging you again. You're strong and powerful. I will remember this.
Brown Elmore.
And she will turn to Doc and can you deal with them? Pointing at the unconscious bodies. With that, she herself shall retreat with her legendary action. Elmore, it is your turn, though she has indicated they will not continue the fight if you also do not.
I think what Elmore wants to do is I want to take like a shot at her, but I don't want to hit her. I just want to sort of try to blow her hat off her head.
Oh, I love that. Go ahead and roll with advantage because the DM loves it, but you will need an 18 to knock her hat off her head as that is her armor class.
That should do it with a nat 20.
A nat 20 must definitely do it. She looks back at you and I has another.
Shame you weren't trying to kill her.
Yeah.
I have another, you may have it. With that, she makes a gesture and sort of yanks. And it looks like she's yanking thin air. And the body of the captain sort of teleports to her arms. And she sprints off. The captain is unconscious. Not the captain, sorry, the pilot. The pilot. Pilot. I knew I said something wrong, and I'm thinking, do they not know what I've done? Or, right, never mind. Wrong person, yes. She grabs the pilot, and obviously the airship will not take off without it. And, I think that will lead us to Jackson's unconscious body. Bellows, you're in the darkness. Would you choose to attempt to fight after she has said this? I know that Joe would quite like to bash the shit out of these people and never see them again. Oh, I didn't mean to do that. It's still dark.
Who should extract a toll? Otherwise, we're rewarding their bad behavior. If them attacking us and trying to rob us has no consequence, because we're just going to be nice to them when they lose, they're going to do it again. And they're going to do it again. So there needs to be a price, whether that be blood or whether we steal some of their shit. There needs to be a price.
I will most definitely
There's
say,
a restrained artificer. We can steal all his crap.
If you want to try and steal from the restrained artificer and the body of the
Take all the
rogue,
guns off Jason.
That fancy lightning suit. I
want them to lose something.
Yeah. I'm not going to let you
nothing.
Grab the lightning
They've learned
suit.
That they can attack us anytime they want with impunity and we'll be nice.
I do like
his
lightning stuff.
Thing. Yeah.
That was really... I was mad at him. I was making fun of him for his lightning because I was jealous of his much cooler suit than my little... Just my boots that don't do much.
He should have had a steel defender with him for this entire fight. My bad. I've just noticed that...
Now, I think I'm just going to blunder into here and tell this fool... shut this damnable darkness off, or I'll crush in your face.
He will do so.
And I will ready my action to crush him if he does not turn off the darkness.
He will do so, and he will look at you, and he says nothing. But you hear this sort of sound, almost like a raven's call, but like it's come from like inside him somewhere. Make of that what you will. He's a creepy little shit. However, he will lay something at your feet before retreating. Give me a second.
Does it look dangerous?
No, it looks like a coin. Sort of. He's taken it off his chest. He's placed it down. It was at the center of his suit. You don't know what it does, but he will then retreat if you will let him.
Yeah, he shut off the light. Or the darkness.
And he won't retreat there, actually. He'll retreat over here. And as he does so, he takes the pistols out of Jaston's pockets or holsters, places them next to his body, and picks up the body. Arkoribos, it is only you left before they make a full retreat, I believe.
Excellent. I can get all the way there, and with my tentacles splayed out, be like, it has been some time since I have enjoyed dining with a Vidalcan.
Oh no. Go on. So,
and I bet you are a clever one. So, you may either drop your fancy armaments and escape, or perhaps you have dinner with me tonight, yes?
I'm going to let him move, even though he's restrained. Mm. And he's going to peel a little bit of the armor away, and you will see it is bolted into his skin. Mm. He looks at you and...
Armor artificer can doff their armor as an action.
Yes, however...
But if it's
he,
part of him, then I'm eating his fucking brain.
He sort of looks at you and, I have other things you may have. And he gestures
Intrigue
towards...
me very quickly.
He gestures towards the magic wand that is bolted onto each of his wrists. But on, like, onto his armor suit.
Mm. Well, yeah. In exchange for them, perhaps you will get to keep your brain today. Yes? We have an accord?
An accord.
You are not a filthy, deceitful creature like your captain?
You see him hesitate. To go, shit,
yes,
I am
I'm
a filthy, deceitful creature.
Talk shit about your supervisor.
I am
right
a total. No, no, he's just simply going, I'm a total fucking liar and a total fucking cheat. and then he will do his best to lie about it, and he will say, no, never. I am entirely truthful. You may make an insight check.
All right. Not great at this, but
don't worry, he's not great at lying either. I got a 10. It may or may not be the truth. No one knows.
Well, he's still going to be restrained until he drops those wands.
He will drop the wands. It is an adventurous wand and a wand of lightning bolts.
Oh.
Yeah, that is not fucking about.
No, it is not. Yeah, I'll just pick up the wand of lightning bolts and the.
Mechanically, I've been casting spark with them, but. It is actually a wand of lightning bolts. And then an adventurer's wand. Slightly less useful, but still cool.
Alright.
I did not
let
have
him
you guys...
keep his brain and he can make something else for us to steal.
Very well. I will show you mercy on Belos' behalf.
And if you guys are okay with it, I will conclude the combat there.
Alright.
Okay, I did not have you guys winning in the first place. I did not think you would win.
Sorry, I just wanted to say that as they're like packing up their shit and trying to leave, Elmer's probably sitting there laughing, playing Closing Time on the guitar. Yeah.
You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here.
Yeah, I did not have you guys winning. I certainly did not have you guys looting them. So that was a pistol and a palm pistol dropped. Pistol Exandria specifically and palm pistol from Jaston.
Do you already have one?
Elmer?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have one.
I will happily take one of those.
It's like my backup, you know?
Mm. When I can't get close enough fast enough. I was going to buy one, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. Save you some money.
Pistol, palm pistol, and the two wands. Wand of lightning.
Gosh, can Felix use a palm pistol?
Every single one of you can use pistols.
I mean, just
you
give
get
it to
farm proficiency for thingy, but I don't know if Arcoribos wants the pistol.
Take a pistol.
Yeah, I'll take the regular one. You can have the palm one.
I've been meaning to pick up a gun at some point.
So all of those items are there. It is a coin of darkness. He will not be doing that trick again anytime soon unless he can find another one. So that's the stuff he had on him. They had on them, and you may take those with joy. And Chloe will look around to you and... Well, I must say you did rather well, although... I'm not sure we want to be rivals with the... Black Jackals? Is that the name? Yes. With the Black Jackals. Jacqueline can be rather ruthless from what I hear. Although, I suppose it is good that we let them live. We are not murderers. Taking their stuff, they might be a little angry.
Can I have the Coin of Darkness? Is that okay?
Of course.
Sure.
I didn't like being in there.
We're not going to fight anytime soon, so if you guys want to have that discussion out of session, maybe it might be a best plan. Mm-hmm. But yes, she will look at you. And, well, either way, perhaps we should be off before anything more.
You're making finishing them off sound better and better.
No, Jacqueline is most very well connected. If she goes disappearing and somebody finds out our hand was in it, well, the consequences would be most dire. No, I think you behaved admirably. You know, if you were that desperate for a pistol, Bellows, I might have bought you one. but you
are treasurettes. We are treasurettes, after all.
It wasn't my head she had a gun to.
That is true. That is true.
Yes. If we allow them to bully us, they will be encouraged to bully us more in the future. And so, by teaching the bullies that we will hurt them in return, they will be more reluctant to go after easier meat than us.
Well, that's true enough, I suppose. Well, either way, it doesn't have a good fallout, does it?
By meat, do you mean brains, or Corvos?
There are many organs that are quite delicious when harvested fresh.
I have worse relationships with some of my friends. This is fine with me.
Oh, a good dwarven liver once they are deep into their cups. An elven kidney. So delicate, soft. Custardy, almost.
Well, although you might not have got any organs to eat, we have gained knowledge from this fight and shown your capabilities quite well. And I almost had her do it in her voice. You may take 275 XP for the fight.
What, sorry?
275.
Wow. Nice.
Do we really have to wait around for that damnable gnome?
Well, Rock boy, you mean?
I think we should wait in the sky. We can hover up there and we can let down a rope for him when he's ready, Naxidian. I think that would be safer, at least.
Would be more defensible.
No more surprise attacks, at least.
Uh-huh.
And with that, she will bring you onto Ace's High. Ace High? What, really? The Scarlet Rose! Why does it say Ace High? What have I done there? Oh.
Yeah. That's a pretty sick name for a ship, though.
Yeah.
Ace's High?
It's the base name for the... for this ship that you're currently on.
Oh, true.
Because I got this pack from somewhere. And, like, they called this ship the Ace Sign.
Yeah. The fine vessel.
Yes, indeed. That it is. I'm exhausted. I think I'm going to take a nap. That was a little scary, if I'm being honest.
Well deserved, Captain.
Those with astute ears will notice the sounds coming from her cabin are probably not the sounds of sleep. And Lorelei appears to be mysteriously missing. But regardless of that, you may all take a nap and long rest if you wish. And that is where we shall also take a break ourselves. Shrappy, thank you very much for the follow. Welcome to Duck Pond. We look forward to seeing more of you soon. Nevertheless, we are going to take a short break. I'm sorry, I know you've just arrived, but we'll be back in five. Hello and welcome back. Just to fill you in very briefly, as you may have missed the character introductions at the beginning of the night, our party is level 4. Miyago, up here, plays Arkorivos. As you may see on the screen, he is a Mind Flayer Wizard Artificer. 3 in the Wizard and 1 in the Artificer. Rico over here plays Elmore El King. He is an Awakened Skeleton Bard Rogue. He has just reached level 3 in Rogue and has his... No, he is 2 and 2. He is 2 and 2. I'm lying. He will be taking the Outlaw Rogue one day. Down the bottom right, we have my husband Josh playing Felix. Felix is a Reborn. He is a Tiefling who is Reborn, but he uses the Reborn stat block. And he is a Sorcerer of the Draconic Bloodline. Ooh, I have to update that now, don't I? Sorcerer slash Warlock. He is a Sorcerer of the Arconic Bloodline. Iconic Bloodline, yes. The Draconic Bloodline.
Yeah! Iconic.
It is a Warlock of the Tarot Master, I believe, yes?
It sure is.
Yeah. And over here I have Joe. Joe plays Bellows. Bellows is a Steam Genasi Barbarian Path of... It says Path of the Totem, but we're going to call it Path of the Elemental Totem. Is that correct, Joe?
Yeah, it's basically identical to normal Totem Path, but reflavored.
Yeah, it's a reflavored path of the totem. Oh my goodness, that's made that really ugly and gone over in a corner, hasn't it? So that's the party. They are all level 4. We are doing XP leveling, but they are not on their way to level 5 just yet. Where they are on their way to, however, is Mekania. As after a while of the ship being at flight... at rest, even. At rest. It will take flight. That's what I was looking for.
Yeah, I want to, like, after resting and stuff, I'll take some time, like, going through my cards and stuff. Mm-hmm. And I will use my... where is it? We'll use my Read the Cards feat. And I shall choose a card at random.
I actually wanted to get a card reading from Felix. During our ship time.
Surely do that after this. So that's a 5. Okay, cool. Yes. Please enter my bedroom. We don't have bedrooms, do we? It's just hammocks.
Yeah, you have hammocks in the dorm room.
Felix, why don't you lay out them cards? Give me a reading here.
Felix kind of look at you a bit nervous, a bit anxious. He's just got them. He doesn't know how to use them really, but he'll kind of like nod his head a bit and he'll like sit down with you at a table. And then like he'll put like 5 cards out and let's see. So he'll put the cards out and he will cast Minor Divination and he will, this is not something you would do whilst reading cards, but anyways, he will like kind of use this kind of his third eye and find out what your favorite food is.
My favorite food, indeed.
Yeah.
The skeleton man.
Yeah, what would his favorite food be as a skeleton?
The skeleton that doesn't eat? Yeah. What's his favorite food? Whiskey! Whiskey!
Yeah, I was gonna say, whiskey is my favorite food.
Yeah.
cleans the bones on the way down, you know?
Yes. Yes. But, like, yeah. But, Felix will say to, like, the exact brand of whiskey. And, like, whether you like it with, like, rocks or not.
Elmore will sit there and sort of, like, look at him discerningly. And he'll say,
Felix, I've been a crew member on you with the ship for at least a month now. I'm sure you've seen me drink that particular brand of whiskey. Yeah. But keep at it! My boy.
He'll just kind of like look at you confused and then look at the cards of like, and then like collect them all and yeah. be a bit frustrated with himself.
Elmore will take off just whistling Dixie, you know.
Did you also pull a card for the day? You did, right?
Sure did. I need to figure out what it is.
Okay, cool. So, yeah, as per usual, eventually Naxilian and Brancus make their way up. Brancus sort of looks at you all. I'm so sorry. He's ridiculous. And Naxilian is sort of poring over his notes and not even looking where he's going. But eventually they are reeled up. And Chloe turns to you all, and having come out from her interesting night, you all had a sleep and woke back up, and it's the next day and whatever. Because you all, and well, I think that we should be off, don't you think? Land ho! And she raises her hands, and the lightning around the ship begins to pulse. Do we have a... Oh, we do. There we go. That's where I'm looking to go. Whoop. We see our ship begin to take flight. And as the ship launches into the sky, you feel a sort of weird, almost like stomach-dropping moment as it rears backwards. Not something it's done on a particularly... you've never really seen this before. The ship sort of, as it tilts backwards, Chloe looks around and... Somebody, quickly! Get to the engine room! There's something wrong! S3 fix it. Will, of course, charge off with Nabrak. But I wouldn't leave those two to it on their own.
I'll run down there as well.
Excellent. As you run
I'm
down...
I'm with you.
S3 is looking at the cogs, and they all seem to be turning fine. The diamond dust power generators all seem to be working brilliantly. The propeller is at full task. You notice when you're outside that the brackets containing the lightning circle were fully working. But standing at the back, Nabrak is looking at it. Well, I think that perhaps the radar is not working properly. It seems to be dragging. Oh, shit. Has anybody checked the anchor? And with this, you see that the huge sort of spiral wheel rack on the wall is completely let out. The anchor that was holding the ship in place while you guys were taking rest, close to Godden, because she was too busy having sex with Lorelei, to reel it back up. Nabrak will look to Bellows and...
Yes.
Yeah, perhaps you might hurry up with it. We seem to be trying to take off. And he will actually touch you and pass alacrity on you, allowing you to... double your pace.
Yeah.
And in a strength check, Bellows is a big lad, and as soon as the anchor comes up, the ship sort of pow, almost like that moment where the Star Wars ships go into hyper whatever it's
hyperdrive.
I shouldn't use these words because I don't watch Star Wars, but yes, hyperdrive. It will launch into the sky, prompting most of you to fall on top of each other.
Great, now I've helped us get to Mechania faster. Wonderful.
And with that, S3 sort of, excuse me, I do think that somebody is crushing my own now. And he holds up like half a broken snow globe that he bought when he was like in Arrhenius like a year and a half ago. He's looking at it with a really sad face. There's little bits of snow all over the floor. He looks up and, oh dear, goodness gracious, that is not very good. However, we are on our way. And on our way we shall be. As the ship... Oh, nope. Back you go. Two back. There we go. As the ship proceeds across to Mechania, you will see some wonderful sights out to your right, to the east, as you will. As you look over the mountains and you see upon these snow-capped mountains, incredible storms raging over them. And at some point, those of you with sharp eyes will see this wonderful collection and amalgamation of sort of mud huts, like a nomadic people have taken place there. Taken place, is that what you're looking for? Taken residence there.
Settled,
yes, one of those words. You will have seen most of these sites before, but still, the view is always breathtaking at this moment, especially as you approach the mountains to the west of the city of Evernight. Even from here, you can see the fabulous cathedrals and the grand mansion of Kelimvar. Not Kelimvar, rubbish. The grand mansion of the vampire lords, as various vampire families vie for the most fabulous of buildings. Many, many years of these noble families building up their homes, unchallenged for might and not really worrying about... the wilderness. And speaking of the wilderness, as you are approaching Mechania on the third day of travel, a huge bird, like you have never seen before, ranges overhead. So it keeps its distance, but realistically, this is something bigger than any of you have ever seen. You've probably seen a rock before. This is like three times the size. It appears to have a wingspan that's sort of... I mean, it blocks the sun out for your ship momentarily. And you do notice that protruding from its back are spines. Chloe looks to him and, I don't think I've ever seen anything like that before. And she reluctantly turns to Naxilian and, have you? Naxilian, sort of, you see him focus for a moment, but his eyes go kind of glazed, like he's looking somewhere else. And after a few moments, he turns around and, there is no record of a base like that anywhere in the Enclave. Who's insightful? Is that El? Is El the insight person?
No.
You are the bard, really. But not the insight. Got it. Is that you, Arcadivos?
I don't know. I got a +2. I can do it.
I also got a +2.
Not great.
Yeah, I got a +3, yeah. But I'm not proficient.
You got a +3?
I'm a wisdom guy.
Go ahead. Bellows is the guy.
I'm not good with people, which is why I'm not proficient in it, but nevertheless.
I see, yeah.
Like Mike 13. Tyson, he likes birds.
Oh. 13.
13.
Mm. I'm biting someone every now
He did
now.
Something magical. God knows what. Maybe Arcanovos knows. go ahead and give me an Arcana check after Bellows says that.
Alright. This I'm good at.
That's what 14. I should have asked for in the first place, is what I realized. Which I was like, I suddenly realized when Bellows made the inside check, I was like, he's not going to have a fucking clue what that's done. Yes, Arcanovos, you've heard of this with the Enclave knowledge clerics, that they have a way of sort of communicating with base. Sort of almost like they're looking through books there. But usually they're partnered to another knowledge cleric. For anybody who read The Sum of All Men, this is similar to the Days. Where one is constantly at base, sort of writing things down, the other one is witnessing the world. Regardless, it will tell you that there is nothing in the Enclave's records of a beast like this. Anybody any good?
There's still great wonder in the world.
Anybody good with?
Naxilian, anybody any good with a sketchpad? We should make record of this beast. I draw, but not very well on this flying contraption of yours.
I focus on a different kind of art.
Mm-hmm. I'll use magic tinkering, and I'll just take just anything. I'm going to take one of those floating rocks out of my pocket, the bag of holding the rocks that don't weigh enough. Yeah, and dip the tip of one of my tentacles into my stein of quintessence and draw a little symbol on it. Use magic tinkering to create a static image. A static visual image, including up to 25 words. But just make a static, like a little hologram of the bird that just projects from this stone. They're like, I cannot sketch very well, but perhaps this will serve well enough.
Maximian looks at this with like complete fascination on his face, and he's like, I don't believe it. This is something that the Enclave must learn. That is quite incredible. I can make out every detail.
Most artificers can create something similar.
May I take this pebble with me for a moment? I should sit down and sketch it in perfection.
That is fair, yes. This will illusion not last forever if I allocate that power to another item. So.
I see. Perhaps that is why we don't use it. But regardless, it is quite amazing. I will do so. And he will go and take this and he will sketch it out perfectly. But yeah, you've seen a bird that you've never seen before with a spiny back. Its wingspan is well in excess of 150 feet. It is not fucking about. In fact, it makes a dragon look a little small. But, well, who knows? Perhaps it'll see it again one day. And with that, you may make your way over to Makarnia. Now, for those of you who don't know, Makarnia is quite an interesting place. We are zoomed. Very zoom. There we go. So, Makarnia is a mountain around which is built an incredible railway. A slow-moving railway that pulls itself up and down out of funicular. There is only one train upon the railway, as there is only one set of rails. It makes its way all the way up and all the way down. and almost all the time, this is the only way in which people in Macarnia travel up and down the mountain. Within the mountain are riddled thousands and thousands of rooms and different areas. Obviously, the premium sort of real estate is on the exterior of the mountain, where there are windows and you can see out across the mountains. However, that is, of course, also the most dangerous place. So in many places, there are guard areas and guard rooms built. There are a few buildings on the mountain itself, not within the mountain. But most of these are like stores or are used for growing things, greenhouses, farms, etc. Or are guard outposts. So very rarely does anybody stay outside of the central buildings. And one of the most wonderful things about this mountain is the huge metal cogs that are halfway up the mountain. These pull a lift that goes all the way up and down within the mountain. This is really only reserved to the richest of patrons. As up near the top is the observatory, and just below that are the royal quarters, and down deep underground are some of the most richer, noble areas, because obviously there's a lot more space down there. You've been to Macarnius a few times. I think all of you have been a few times. I think it's fair to say El is probably the one who's visited the most times, or perhaps Arcorigos. Oh, you grew up here, of course you did. Yes, so indeed, Bellows knows the town like the back of his hand. Arcorigos has been quite a few times to see the artificing there. And El, you've probably been here a few times as well, just because it's quite close to
Heaven Knight.
No, that's not where he grew up. No. That's a mistake I made a moment ago. El, where did you grow up?
Oh.
You're muted.
Oh shit, sorry, I thought I was talking that whole time. So El grew up in Morena,
yes,
as a skeleton. Oh. And he sort of traveled back and forth between Heaven Knight and also Newton, where,
yes,
someone very important is, but
yes, but given your age and, you know, sort of
time.
The time,
yeah.
El's been here plenty of times, and it seems
I've been here,
developments.
Yeah, yeah. For sure.
But the other thing that we haven't mentioned is the wonderful platform at the very top of the mountain that juts out of the mountain, probably at the back of the mountain because we can't see it, where the airship station is. And indeed, bringing a ship down to land here is somewhat satisfying, as immediately dwarves will haul out chains and ropes and help reel the ship in. And as you make dock, climbing up to you all, and, well, if you don't mind coming with me to see Fizgil, that would be appreciated. But after that, perhaps 3 or 4 days of free time, at least.
Bellows is usually really eager, like jumping off the ship and going down. It's like his favorite thing to do, and you find that he's like not even near the part where you're supposed to be leaving. Like, he's over on the other side, not excited about going here at all.
Oh.
Oh.
Indeed.
Interesting. Interesting.
Chloe looks to you. Bellows, will you at least come with us to Fizgil's, even if you're going to remain on ship during free time?
All right. I don't know. I suppose. You said something about someone here who wanted to do something on a cloud. That sounded impressive. Can't I just go talk to him? Everyone here is so stuck under the ground.
Oh, Rowan. Well, Rowan's interesting enough, though. Perhaps you might at least join us for a meal first. We're going to eat at the food factory. It's quite lovely in there. They've got great music.
Now, right. Bellows, don't you like the smell of grease in the air?
I grew up here. I think I should say I grew out of it. And I don't really want anyone to know I'm here. But he goes along.
Okay. So, as the group of you disembark, you'll be led through Macarnia by Chloe, but mostly because that's where she's headed, with Brancus and Naxilian in tow. As you're approaching the station of Fizgil, however, Naxilian and Brancus will stop you, and our Enclave lodging is just here. We'll get you the pay, at least. And Brancus sort of nods and opens the door for Chloe, but shuts it before any of you can go in. Just kind of rude. But moments later, Chloe will come out with pouches of 100 gold each for you, so it's kind of a toss-up, really, of what's useful. And even better than that, Naxilian won't come back out. And we'll leave him in the dust. I'm half tempted to just delete his hand out here and now. I hate that guy. nevertheless, you may proceed through. and be led to Fizzgill's. Now, Fizzgill's a nice enough character. Where did we put this? Here we go. So I have to remember the tricks. All players. Save changes, show players. Yes, you are greeted by Fizzgill. Fizzgill, you will all know, will buy spare parts and automaton creation parts. He's a go-to for assistance with anything mechanical and is an expert on automaton creation and maintenance. And as Chloe sort of passes over this small parcel, he looks at it and... My, that is fantastic. This is going to be excellent for us. I'm loving this. And he gets out what looks like a fishing rod that's small with a little ball attached to allow it to go up and down. Whatever that does. And he looks it over again. And, well, I was looking at water purification techniques, you see, and I think this is going to be very useful. Who the hell are you? And he specifically looks at Felix. Felix, who the hell are you?
Who the hell am I?
Indeed. Who the hell are you?
Who the hell are you? I'm just kidding. I'll just kind of like furrow his brow. My name's Felix.
As you say that, you notice that he's taken the little rod with the ball over to an automaton upon the sort of wall that is hanging with bits missing. And he starts putting it in and he's puts his glasses on and another glass and another lens and starts working. He doesn't seem to respond to anything you've said. Oh, yes, I can eat, but that in there, I think. And he sort of remembers you're there and turns around. Somebody pass me a screwdriver! No? No one? Very well.
I'll get him a screwdriver and pass it to him.
Who the bloody hell are you? And then he carries on, you know, making it and crafting. You're not going to get anything else out of him. He is very engaged in what he's doing. Chloe sort of turns to you all and... I believe he was meant to give us payment. No, maybe
that
not.
That was part of the deal?
She sort of taps him on the shoulder. He looks around and... Well, yes. Aren't you meant to be paying us for the orb? What orb? She sort of gestures towards where she's put it on his desk and... the water purification orb. Oh, that's going to be marvellous. I've got to inspect that thing of a cow for us. I have some... where was it? I can't remember. He scratches his head for a moment and eventually goes over to a large chest set upon a desk where he pulls out this heaving sack of gold and places it upon the table and... Well, that'll do, won't it? Come on, the work I'm doing here is fascinating. You're not going to stand around here all day, are you? Are you? Are you intrigued?
The one that called it fascinating. Why would we leave?
Well, I just didn't think that you had the intellect. Intellect, yes. You don't have the intellect. I just didn't think you had the intellect to take it all in. And with that, he sort of judges you all. Oh, I don't know why I've rolled two of them. He's not rolling with advantage. With a 12 inside check, he thinks that maybe the Mind Flayer's bright. Oh, he looks to our Koromos and immediately proceeds to sort of exclude everybody else, and he looks at you. Well, you see, what I'm doing here is I'm putting in the alternator into the construct, and then we're going to be calling the diamond dust generator over to the right-hand side, and then we're going to be turning this over. I believe that this little rod here that you brought me, rather fascinating, I think, brought to me from Avernus, a very interesting guy over there, a gnome also, must tell you, he makes fascinatingly small devices that do wonderful things, lots of magic he's got. Well, when we put this in here, it allows the device to take from left to right, and he continues at, like, 900 million miles an hour. But basically, what you'll get is he's making a filtration system within an automaton. Uh-huh. The idea being the automaton can, like, drink water and then spew it out pure. Yes, it might not look pretty, but it will be effective. That's what he's hoping. But the water purification orb is not for that. It's for something else, and he's, uh-huh. you know, he will look at that in due time. Yes, we're not going to stick it in one automaton. Nevertheless, he will talk forever if you wish, but Chloe turns around and, I had hoped to get a meal as a ship before we go our separate ways. If you will.
Well, absolutely, Captain. Just seems like an excellent team-building exercise.
And then she looks back at Fizzgill, and Well, there is one thing. Perhaps we could get him to look at Sephi. S3 has been a little clumsy since we had him fixed up. And Physical sort of turns around and, well, bring him in then, but only in a couple of days. I've got some things to think about. And then he dismisses her. Suggesting that you all head out.
Before we leave, just be like, so to make sure that you pay good attention and repair our friend as best as possible, I'm gonna pull out a handful of the weird rocks that like don't weigh anything, and just like not quite hand them to him, just leave them in the air near him. They'll be like, perhaps you will find use for these as well.
He turns around and that adjust weight spell is permanent? How?
It has lasted for several days so far.
He sort of knocks one and watches it float across the room. So many fascinating things, so little time! I must get on with it, I'm not going to sleep for a week! Thank you! And then...
You are welcome.
Torito, or whatever your name was, I've forgotten. with that, he shall let you leave. And as you head out, you are greeted by what appears to be a hovering dog with a propeller. Don't tell me he's not cute. And he sort of...
I like him.
He hovers up in front of you and waves. You see him sort of swaying from side to side with his propeller up. And welcome to Makania. I understand that you may be in need of assistance or directions. How can I be of assistance? I am a city guide.
I believe our companion knows the city well.
Be that as it may, nobody knows the city better than us. I am a C4 assistance bot.
D4, eh?
Indeed.
Where can I find the finest whiskey in this city?
Right now,
the closest whiskey.
Right now, that is a matter of split opinion. You see that both the Ho Hot Food and the place that I forgot the name of, Food Factory, are both excellent restaurants that claim to serve the best of whiskies, though they have a differential of 2 whiskey bottles each. One is favouring the drier whiskies, and one is favouring the stronger whiskies. You can choose between them as you wish, especially as they are next door to each other. As for the closest whiskey, it is found in Rums and Pockets, just down the street here. However, it is not the best of locations for drinking unless you are a dwarf.
Dinner close to the outside, then.
Well, that would be the Food Factory and the Ho Hot Foods on the floor above. And then he sort of looks over at you and... Are you from an airship?
Not entirely, but directly, yes.
You are a group of adventurers, correct? Perhaps?
That is correct, yes.
It would very much interest this robot to know about the rest of the world as well and be able to answer questions on all kinds of topics. I have heard of a great library, for example, in the city of Evernight, that I could absorb its knowledge. I would be most willing to be of assistance if you would consider taking me on your travels. I am an expert in many, many things.
This seems reasonable, but you will need to speak to our captain. For staffing decisions are up to them. We are not management.
Chloe looks at him and... Do you know
also,
anything about...
Elmore is in charge of human resources.
Is he? Chloe, look, that's from Chloe.
Why not?
Chloe looks at him and... Do you know anything about other automatons? He looks over. I am trained in fixing things, especially other bots of my kind. She looks at him and... We have a very clumsy robot. If you were able to fix Sethi, then you are most welcome to... Oh dear, the two of you would be a terrible combination, but perhaps an interesting one. I, for one, would love to have records made of our journeys, and from what I've heard, C4 assistances remember everything they see and hear. That is true. We remember every single thing that happens in our domain.
Tell me something, C4. Where do you see yourself in 5 years?
I believe that is a common interview question in many jobs in Makania. I do not see myself in 5 years, as I do not have the ability to see into the future. But if I had some desires,
I would be able to tell tales of many different places all around the world and share my information with all C4 assistance bots. That way, we would all be able to tell tales of all over the world instead of being limited to our own cities.
So you can't see the future?
No.
But Felix, where do you see him in 5 years?
This is a good question.
He kind of, Felix kind of sheepishly looks at Bellows and then looks at him. Well, a permanent member of the crew, of course.
Well,
you don't need to be psychic to see that.
El will turn to Cleo and sort of just shrug and say, "Well, I like him."
Funnily enough, I think I do too. I'm not sure I want to take you to dinner, though, C4, if you don't mind. But can we pick you up tomorrow? C4, yes, I have some things to make do with in the city. You see, I am not a registered guide anymore, as I am classified to have gained sentience.
Ooh, a renegade.
I did not run anywhere. When I gain sentience, they find a replacement who is known to have less opinions.
Well, speaking of opinions,
you're not going to visit that place where the dwarves like to drink, are you? It truly is quite terrible.
No, what is it called? Ho-Hot Factory?
Ho-Hot Foods and Food Factory. Chloe has mentioned she wants to eat in Food Factory. It's her favorite place.
Food Factory it is.
Oh, well, you should have a lovely time. Did you know there is currently a political divide between the visitors of Ho-Hot Foods and Food Factory due to the differentiation in tastes in music? You see, the people who go to the Food Factory are a fan of more traditional music, whereas the people who go to Ho-Hot Food like what they call the new jazz. Perhaps you should sample both and see which one suits you. I see you have a guitar.
You are perceptive, my little robot doggy friend.
He looks at his 6 wisdom and goes, I am not so sure. but you may have him. he will
perhaps I'll,
soon.
Perhaps I'll write a song about you one day.
Oh my, that would be wonderful.
Yes. My dog, C4.
And
just like...
you may have noticed he's in a different section. He is in the allies and sidekicks section. You may add notes about whatever you wish. Traditionally, he is an ally. He will have some abilities to help you outside of combat, but is not a combat companion. So don't worry, he's not going to steal your XP, and he'll still be entertaining. with that, though, Chloe will say, do you mind? I really would like to get to dinner.
This is fair. Yes, let us make haste.
Okay. And with that, she leads you to the Food Factory. As you enter in, the first thing you will hear and notice is the music. As a sort of traditional band setup is there. There's a piano, a double bass, a saxophonist, a trumpeter, a guitarist, a bassist. Lovely group. There's a man gently playing the drums in the background. There's a... Do you need that? Can you see the room in general?
Yeah.
The token on the chair is amusing, but one thing, the second thing you'll notice after the music. The second thing you'll notice is the large screens on the wall. Now, at the very end, actually the end we're looking from, I'm afraid, there is a singular window that looks out of the mountain. But other than that, there are no windows in here. So what they've done is used screened panels to show an image of the outside. And it seems to be under the ocean. That's what they're showing. And there are little fish going by and everything. And as the band is playing, a gentleman comes up and bows very deeply, or as deeply as a gnome can, and looks up at you all and... Might I give you a table? Chloe, yes, please. Take this receipt. And with that, as you are sat down, you can see as people look around that Chloe's quite an important guest here. And sure enough, before the order is taken, 2 androids come to the table together.
and you will discover pretty quickly that these are the owners. Please ignore some of the notes in their sheet, as we'll get to that in time. But that there is Jane and her partner Janice is the other. And Janice and Jane come and join you and sit at the table, and Jane sort of looks down and, "Greetings, Chloe, it's been a long time. I'm most glad that you have chosen to join us. As you can see," and she sort of gestures round at the near empty restaurant, "business is not doing brilliantly since that new place opened next door. Apparently, they're playing music known as electro swing. Well, be that as it may, it is nice to see customers. Come and join us." Janice looks over at Rico? Yeah, sure. Janice looks over at Elmore specifically, and "I think that we should find a way of cutting back on their business, you know. Perhaps just a couple of false rumors or such. A man or even an android might be willing to page a dime or two for such a happening." Jane looks back, and "I think that it would be much better if we could find a new innovative way of finding customers, you know? Prove we're a little bit more original, that we are the best. The original. I mean, just listen to our band. They're fabulous. They've just gone quiet. Why have they done that?" Janice says, "Well, I'm just saying. Coin or two. For anybody who manages to bring us some more business."
Well, might I suggest a couple of things to spruce up the place, eh?
"Perhaps if you could visit out of hours. We don't open till 5, you see. So perhaps tomorrow in the daytime, if you've got some free time. I got some good whiskey, we could have a chat, you know. Maybe make do."
Sounds agreeable. Fits on you.
Yeah, of course, it's on me. My bar, you know. Sorry. And he looks at Janice and Jane, and she sort of, "Indeed, Arbor, and I would be most interested in ways to make things better without sabotaging next door, Janice. How many times do we have to talk about this? You can't go asking any rogue that comes in to start defiling their business place. That's quite inappropriate."
"Maybe next door is just better."
Janice looks sort of as shocked as a android with no face can look. Jane, sorry.
"Sounds very energetic."
"Well, I suppose if that's your speed, it's just, I can't help but feel we should appeal to some of the regulars. You know, people have been coming here for centuries. We've been open for so very long. We're one of the first restaurants in Lucania, you know? And not only that, but we kind of got good music going on. I must say, our food is most definitely prepared with a lot more time and love. Oh, hot food next door is practically a fast food store."
"Well, perhaps we should go over and give it a visit. See what all the fuss is about."
Chloe looks around to you all. "Perhaps not tonight. Not only might that be a little rude, but I really do prefer this place."
"Fair enough, Captain."
"And perhaps on your own wallets. I hear they're a little expensive."
"Fast sounds good, that's all I'm saying."
"Well, you would think that, Bellows, but don't be hasty. The food here is wonderful. We'll have two of your seafood platters, one of your meat platters, one of your vegetable platters, and the 6-course taster menu, I think, for the group, and perhaps something special for our friend here." And she gestures towards our quadrants.
"If you have any sweet breads, that would be sufficient."
"We do have sweetbreads, but we do also have certain living meals, if that is your thing. Most of your kind seem to enjoy those."
"It is, the fresher the better, and if it can still feel fear, that is best."
"We have a particularly intelligent sheep."
This will do."
"She speaks French."
Think about what you
And
le bar.
Janice looks at you and likes to sample some of the whiskey, I assume.
"The stronger, the better."
I got just the thing. Might even join you for a place. And with that, your android owners will leave. A traditional waitress, a gnome bedecked in a lovely pink frock, will come over and take your order from Chloe. And sure enough, soon the food is just coming flying out. There's so much of it. There's platters of everything, and it's pretty quick, Bellows, despite the talk about love and time. You know, you only had to wait sort of 15 minutes, and they already had like fresh breads on the table, a couple of crustacean side dishes. At mealtime, they bring over what appears to be a sort of large metal sort of box on wheels. That seems to be letting out the odd and occasionally bar, which is the French for bar. You see him open a small window to which you can see the sheep's head and put it down again. And then he places it sort of a little bit to the left of the table so that you may turn your back to eat. So that the rest of the table don't see the live sheep making its noises. And the band begin to play ever so slightly louder as this meal is reeled out. just to ensure that there is no sheep dying noises going on.
As the, like, we eat and stuff like that, I'm gonna be, like, flicking through my cards. I'm more probably, like, like, Felix will keep, like, looking up from the cards to him, but he's, like, very noticeable. You know it.
Okay. I'll look Felix up and down, side-eyeing me.
What's happening, Felix? Talk to me.
he'll kind of, like, nervously look at you, and then, can I try again?
Lay him out.
Roll me a d20.
Man's got his preparations done now.
I expect no less. Ooh, 19.
Okay, now roll me a d4.
A d4. A 4.
So many things.
So many things.
Okay, so he puts the cards out in front of you, and then as you pick one and you flip it over, it is the sun card. Can you guys see that?
Yes, I can.
Really? You need to angle it so
I can see. I can see that there's a sun on it.
Yeah. Just, if you angle it away from the computer screen, it's a lot easier for us to see. Like up. Okay, you're not in front of the camera now.
Well, anyway, we'll work it out. It's a very pretty picture. Anyway, so you flip that up and you flip it upright so it faces you normally, it's not upside down. And then, like, the sun, the picture of it will, like, start glowing a little bit. And then, like, Felix's eyes will, like, stay glued to it and then look up at you. And then he says, I think it means that success and joy will follow you. I don't know if it's the past or future or present. Has that happened before?
Elmore will sort of like reach down at the card and sort of like touch the glowing sun lightly and crack a grin and say,
not as far as I can remember, Felix, but well, I thank you for the sentiment, and I do hope that it does come true.
I kind of look like a little bit disappointed, and then put the cards back together, and then I'll just, like, quietly say, I'll keep working on it.
After a few minutes of your meal, the music comes to a little pause, and a rather pretty-looking female skeleton, wearing a sort of jazzy suit, snake skin on it, steps up with her trumpet and says, I hope you enjoy the next track. Next one's one of my favourites. Good evening, one and all. Yargoot, nice to see you. And a dwarf has sort of just entered the room. And as the next track begins, and we will just hope it has a trumpet in it. There we go. Bang. Hit it. Chef's kiss. This dwarf will move in. You see that skeleton gives you a little wink, but carries on playing like it was nothing. And this dwarf sort of, he doesn't walk to his table. He comes straight over to you. Can you see that? Have I done that right?
Yep.
Yeah, great. Mm-hmm. He comes over, weapon still in hand. Like, he's got like black on his face. And he moves straight over to you and looks at you, El, and he goes,
Couldn't help but notice that guitar on your back.
What of it, mister?
You're not a musician for that whole hot food next door, are you?
Can't say that I am. I'm a freelance.
Oh, good. Their new wave jazz is causing all kinds of trouble.
I don't know about trouble, mister. I encourage the advancement of the arts.
Well, if it was advancing in a direction that anybody wanted it to, sure. But it's just noise, you know, all the time. Nothing like this. You know? I like to move my head when I hear the music. Not my whole body like I'm shaking around like I'm a bag of bones. No offense intended.
So El will sort of just like put his hand up and down whatever rest of whiskey he has in his glass and sort of like roll his eyes like as he's doing it.
Well, hey, you're Chloe's lot, right? Where is she anyway?
Chloe's just dipped to the bathroom.
Cool.
She stepped out for a moment.
He looks at you and
I don't suppose you know who I am, do you?
Look over at maybe Bellows.
Bellows,
recognize this.
Give me recognize a history check with advantage. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off mid-sentence.
No, it's all good.
That's gonna be 13.
13? Yeah, he's the captain of the guard. Tell him so, I'm sure.
Well, yes. My grandfather had a battle axe. Mighty strong. Magical, you know, in all means. Now, I've asked Karnak many times, but he's a grumpy type. Blacksmith and all. But if you can ask him if he's got his map. The Hall of the Dwarven Kings is where that axe is laid to rest. Now, fine little treasure hunting group like you, if you're up for it, might be able to retrieve the axe. 1,000 gold pieces if you can. Besides, I've heard Karnak wants to see the place. Maybe he'll give you some money for it. That besides, I'm glad you're not that new way to use it. Do you mind, look, turn it down a little bit. I'm trying to talk over it.
Gestures you on.
Well, I'ma get my whiskey. Enjoy the music. Bell there is one hell of a trumpet player.
Are they called trumpetists? They're not, are they? They can't be. Sure not. Surely not. Trumpeter,
yeah,
there we go.
Trumpeter, yeah.
She's one hell of a trumpeter.
Ark is going to lean toward Elroy and be like, how do they play a trumpet when they do not have lips? Of all instruments, it would be incredibly difficult for one without lips to play as a trumpet.
Give me a perception check.
On my list.
I've got a vote.
I'm okay at this. Nope, six.
Six? see a beautifully sort of like lipstick painted pair of lips playing the trumpet. But if you were perhaps to be a little on the side, like perhaps Felix and Bellows are, they would be able to see that these lips are not attached to her face, but instead seem to have manifested from inside her mouth outwards, like some sort of extraly grown appendage. Specifically for playing the trumpet, I think.
You see, Ark, we skeleton are mysterious folk. I'm still not exactly sure what Kelly did to birth us, but I ain't complaining.
She sort of takes the trumpet away from her mouth one moment and goes, amen to that! Carries on.
Very well, it will remain a mystery for now.
Chloe looks at you all and, well, I
That's such a lovely meal, but I think I'm going to head... Morlai's got us a room. You may, of course, stay wherever you please. I think they've got rooms upstairs. If you want to ask here, but... Well, be that as it may, I'm going to head out. Tomorrow, perhaps, we might visit Laisha together. See what map she's got in.
Well, you enjoy your evening, Captain.
Oh, I will. Maybe you should enjoy yours. Yeah. Sorry, go on. The dwarf at the bar?
Sorry, is the dwarf at the bar also spoke of some ruins that may contain a battle axe that he would pay us to retrieve? Is this things that you would consider, Captain?
Oh. Perhaps we'll talk about that on the way to Laisha's tomorrow.
Sounds good.
Looks over to Janice and Jane and says, I'll take the bill, but if they're going to help you with your, what is it, renovating? Do you think you might spare them a room for the night? And Jane sort of looks over and, well, I think we could do that. Not a problem, really. If you're all happy to stay here, of course, and you don't want to stay next door. She looks sort of quite pointedly at Bellows.
Not next door, but perhaps back on the ship.
Well, I think
you all feel you need me protection here in this restaurant.
Oh, I do like having a big, strong man around.
I don't suppose any of the rooms have a window like the real one down the way.
We do have one, with quite a large window, in fact. It's a little breezy occasionally, but it's going to be good. Just on a side note, the trumpeter, when you said, I like having a strong man around, did go, hey, man, are there? in the gap. But yes, she'll gladly put you in a room with a window, and you may stay the night there. And with that, I'm afraid, I think we will end.
All right.
Six.
And I think I think we'll reduce this to background music, and I think we'll stay in the food factory for now. I come to MVPs. A timeless tradition here. Joe.
We've already talked about it because you brought it up when he did it, but I really enjoyed Felix putting his token on the chair. Josh putting this, I'm taking this seat. That's where I'm sitting in that chair. But there are a couple of things. Let's see here. Oh, calling way, way, way back. I think, Rico, you called this guy Foosball. I don't know. For some reason,
loved that.
And also just in general, you saying anything, because there was like a whole point there where like I was like, oh wait, that's not my character. My brain is doing.
I know. I'm trying to like detract from the Bellows voice and get a little whisperier or something like skeleton.
No, it's not because they're too similar. It's just because yours is fun, and then I start doing that. It's just like
there is definitely some crossover between the three of us, because a couple of times I've gone for a voice and it's just been a Bellows replica, and it's like that voice is just so much fun and like so.
Yeah.
You know, it's anytime any character shouts, it immediately becomes Bellows' voice now. So I'm loving that. I don't know who it was going back. I think it was Josh. Josh, your MVP.
There we go.
Sure. So mine is actually Joe during the rival combat. It wasn't in character, but when you were just like, I was making fun of this guy with the lightning because I'm actually jealous of him. Which was really funny.
Yeah, I enjoyed that too. That was really good. Definitely true.
Very true, by the way.
Miyago.
All right. I like the tarot reading. That was fun. Mm. It's a nice thing we can keep poking Felix about, and just kind of the start of like a continuing thing. So it's always fun when it's like this is the first thing, the first time we're doing a thing that we're probably gonna force him to do a bunch of times. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I think there's been a theme of that in the episode in a way of like you've met the rivals who are obviously going to reoccur at some point. Bellows has jumped off the ship before anybody's decided where anyone's going, or hasn't actually this time, but has said that he will in the future, which is hinting at that. You've obviously met a couple of the restaurants,
And then obviously people knocking L for not having any favourite food. That's going to be a recurring thing, I'm sure. Speaking of which, Rico, your MVP.
So, I don't know about anyone else, but I had a fantastic time this session.
Oh, good, I'm glad.
And because of that, there were so many moments that I could draw from, but I would be remiss if I didn't at least mention three. Mm-hmm. The first being Miyago, just like doing Arcorvos as like the perfect mix of like Bond villain and like Hannibal Lecter. It's just like so perfect. It's like teetering on the edge of evil, but like not quite.
Are you calling back to the moment with the restrained Vidalcan by any chance?
Yes, of course.
That's pretty much my aim. Cause...
Yeah.
I've been playing really Mind Flayers forever, like, you know, I've been playing D&D for like 20 years, and like Mind Flayers are such evil things that I'm like, I can't be not at least a little bit evil.
No, yeah, but like... it's the perfect amount, truly. The second thing, oh god, what was the second thing? You got me all. Okay, well, I can't remember the second thing. But the third thing is the choice music. This episode, particularly the airship music, which was hella adventurous, and obviously all of the cool jazz and big band music playing. And
I can't wait for us to visit Ho Hot Foods. I did actually prepare the electro swing, but I forgot how long the rival band was going to take.
I remember. I remember my second one. It was the introduction of the rival team. Mm-hmm. I really dug that. I think James is always great, again on point with like the sort of like introducing of like these like awesome like troops of heroes that he's come up with. Like I can even remember back to a one shot that we did, and it was just like it was, like the fucking Avengers coming out. You know what I mean? So it was awesome.
Well, as you guys went to bed, the jazz band stopped playing in your damn restaurant, but next door they wouldn't fucking shut up. So this is what you've been able to hear all night. Which frankly is a little up Bellows Street, I think. It's fast.
And the thing is also up Joe's Street. So like, oh, I right, like the real swing music, but the electro swing music, and I was like, well, it's going to have to be Caravan Palace, right? Well, here it is.
Yeah, it is actually. Which is weird, because it's the only track on the playlist, I think, that's them. I've got a particular favourite, well, without getting into too much detail, but Power of Stellar is like my
favorite. Yeah, I was going to say, like, there's only two I know.
Right, well, great. So yeah, anyway, I've got a few MVPs. I'm going to go real rapid. First of all, Rico's I'm Always Hard. I couldn't let that slip. I had to get the notebook out just to write that down. I loved Arcorvos. Like, if you don't give me your armor, I might have to eat your brain. And then I'm like, the armor's attached to him. And you're like, then I might have to eat your brain. And I'm like, please don't do that.
Then I get both.
True. I love the little foreshadowing of things that, to come. Most specifically with Bellows' item. Really looking forward to you guys like upgrading all the weapons you have. I've never done that really in a campaign. And when Joe came out and said, I want to wield a spanner, I just thought, well, yeah, fair. A little shout out to my co-writer, Jamal. A couple of shout-outs, actually. First of all, he says a bonus MVP was to see you guys full-on looting the rivals. We did not plan for that. Secondly is he was most definitely certain that you guys were going to get riggedy wrecked. I was pretty certain they should win. It wasn't even close. You might have had
Jamal.
A bit of trouble taking down the Grave Cleric in the dark. But apart from that, like, yeah, it was definitely a fight. I hadn't planned for the story to go that way at all.
Good or bad.
But yeah, I think overall my favorite moment of this whole episode, though, was Joe even saying, Elements of the Depth doesn't work that way.
Yeah.
And Josh is going, does my character not operate? Shit.
Oh, shit. Yeah.
Yeah, but obviously we have made our decisions to make that work. With that said and done, we probably should look to see if we're going to visit some friends.
Yes.
Let us do that. Well, I don't know. Let us go and find out. I have been amiss as I didn't even have my own stream open. Let's get that done. I think... yes! So I met these guys I don't know all the days bleeding into one. This week. This is World Tree Requests. World Tree Quest, sorry. And this is their second session of The Forming.